South Carolina won the toss and deferred, so they'll be kicking away. Darius Sims and Torin McGaster back deep. Landon Ard to kick, and here we go at Williams-Brice to the corner. It's going to be Fielding at about the 3-yard line, and he's not going to get to the 20. Dropped at about the 16-yard line. Austin Carter Samuels, who transferred from Wyoming a couple of years ago, now the undisputed starter. And he's an interesting story, yeah. And he's a pretty darn good quarterback.
I like him. I've watched him on film this year. He's got good poise. The ball's out of his hands quickly. Pretty good accuracy throwing it, and he can also move and scramble in the pocket.
The guy we talked about, Jordan Matthews, is to the bottom of your screen. First snap from the 17. He's looking that way and goes that way and is complete out to the 21-yard line. Pick up a 5 as we take a look at our Chick-fil-A impact players. Jordan Matthews, we've already talked about him. He's got a catch already. Jerron Seymour gets his start in the backfield. On the other side, Chad Sutton makes some plays because they run away from Jadeveon Clowney. And Kadedrick's Marcus is back in at safety. I think that should shore up the secondary a little bit tonight.
Right away, we see something that Vanderbilt does a lot. They bring an extra offensive lineman in, number 50, Jelks, and he's lined up in the tight end position.
Carter Samuels on the move, and a tough throw, incomplete, intended for Matthews.
Even though they would have loved to have got the completion there, the good thing is they broke a tendency, because coming into the game, when they brought that heavy look in, whether it's 6 linemen or 7, they have not thrown the football very much. It's been primarily run when they bring the extra linemen in. First time they show it, they throw a pass.
Last year, Vandy was only 3 out of 15 on their third down conversions against South Carolina. South Carolina wasn't much better, in fact. But it's a different quarterback.
South Carolina said they wanted to try to double Matthews on third down. Here he is up here at the top on this first third down play.
They've got 3 receivers that way on third down at 5. Carter Samuels got a man right in his face, and down he goes. Chaz Sutton with a sack.
Not sure I understand this protection, because this is just a defensive end, Chaz Sutton, that comes unblocked. There's nobody to account for him. It's not a blitz. It's a 5-man rush, and Sutton comes untouched to the quarterback.
That's just too easy.
Yeah.
And so Taylor Hudson's going to have to punt. And a 3-and-out for Vanderbilt on their opening series. Bruce Ellington waits back near the 40-yard line. He's been kind of quiet so far this year due to injuries. He fields this one at the 46 on the fly. And Bruce Ellington with a stiff arm and goes out of bounds at the 42-yard line. So only a 38-yard punt and a 13-yard return.
38 yards and way too low. I mean, if you're going to kick an end-over-end punt like that, you better get it on the ground and bounce it out of bounds. Ellington was easily able to return that one.
Connor Shaw, who's done a great job at home, where he is 11-0. He's had some trouble on the road, including last week in his home state of Georgia, even though he had a good game. But they came up short in that one, 41-30.
Last year against Vanderbilt in an opener on a Thursday night, he played very courageously. Hurt his shoulder in the second quarter, came back and finished the game. Actually scored the game-winning touchdown on a run. Had 92 yards rushing last year from the quarterback position.
Mike Davis flushes out of that South Carolina backfield and goes out as a wide receiver to the left side, leaving Brandon Wilds with Connor Shaw in the backfield. And now got a stoppage in play before the first offensive snap. Not sure if the down marker's in the, first of all, it's first down. There we go. That'll help. You know, you got one job to do. That's what my wife always tells me. You got one job to do and you mess it up. So now we'll snap it at the 42-yard line. And again, they put Davis and Wilds both back there in an overloaded pistol set. And it will be Connor Shaw, the keeper. And a nice run, 9 yards for Shaw. And South Carolina already deep in Vandy territories. We look at our Chick-fil-A impact players. Mike Davis, he's had 75-yard runs in both games so far this year. Nick Jones came on big time in the fourth quarter against Georgia last week. We'll see if they go more to him. Walker May, a good outside rusher. And Andre Howell, coaches for Vanderbilt, think he's one of the most underrated defensive backs in the SEC. Second down and a yard. Shaw, easy throw and catch. Brandon Wilds, 4 yards in the first down.
One of the problems that this Vanderbilt defense has had, even in the midst of their success here the last 2 years, has been quarterbacks that can run the football. They had a little trouble with Bo Wallace and Barry Brunetti from Ole Miss in the first game. You take a look at those four quarterbacks, three of those teams they lost to last year, the quarterback, a big reason why.
That Jeff Driscoll of Florida was a big one, 177 yards and 3 touchdowns. This guy can definitely run. It's the best part of his game. Not that he doesn't throw the ball well. He's not the biggest guy in the world, but he's shifty and he has another nice game.
And he makes good decisions. I think that's the biggest thing about him. He has a very high football IQ. Steve Spurrier trusts him with the ball in his hands, and he makes very strong decisions through the course of the football game, when to keep, when to give, when to throw it away, when to take a chance.
Davis and McLaurin with him in the backfield on second down and a long four. Going to flare it out. Nice throw to Davis, who got it in stride, and Davis inside the 15 and down to the 12. Can't throw that pass any better.
You mentioned the key phrase, in stride. When you throw to a running back, you don't want to make him slow down or reach back for the ball. You want to let him catch it quickly out in front and get his eyes ahead so he can make one guy miss in space. And that's exactly what Davis was able to do. Because the ball was well thrown, he could make the first guy miss.
So first down of the Vandy 12-yard line. And Shaw keeps it. And only got back to the line of scrimmage. Kenny Ladler that time comes underneath from the secondary, made the stop.
Now last year, I think the reason there was so much opening for Shaw to run is because of Marcus Lattimore. There was so much attention by the Vanderbilt defense on Lattimore that early in the game, that's when Shaw had some running lanes. And it appears that way in the ball game so far tonight. Mike Davis coming into the game, over 100 yards in both his first two starts, and Connor Shaw has some running room.
Lattimore had 110 yards and a couple of touchdowns in that win last year. Shaw in the shotgun goes to the end zone. Touchdown. And it is Nick Jones. So one of our impact players makes an early impact. Nick Jones, 12-yard touchdown catch.
You mentioned the throw on the swing pass to Davis. This throw might have been even better, because there were defenders around Nick Jones, and Connor Shaw had to put it in one spot at the back of the end zone where only his guy had a shot to make a play.
Elliott Fry, the freshman, in for the point after. Great start for South Carolina. They had a short field. Connor Shaw knew it and knew his team had to only go 42 yards in 6 plays. And he throws a 12-yard strike to Nick Jones. South Carolina, 7-0. South Carolina's fans finding success, brought to you by Expedia, on the touchdown to Nick Jones.
Well, Nick Jones is going to be lined up in the slot. He's right here. And you're going to see Connor Shaw. There's only one place for him to throw, and that's right there at the back of the end zone in between three defenders. You cannot put the ball in a better spot. Only your guy has a chance to make the catch. If it's incomplete, it's out of the back of the end zone. As it was, perfect throw results in a Carolina touchdown.
Connor Shaw, 3 for 3 to 3 different receivers on that drive. The last 12 to number 3. One of our impact players. There's his numbers on the year. So South Carolina early 7-0 advantage. Darius Sims and Torin McGaster again back deep. Last time they didn't get it out to the 20-yard line on the kick. This one should be returnable as well, right from the goal line. Sims across the 25. Nice return out to the 30. The ball came out. I think he was down. Well, there's still a mad scramble for it, but the linesman's got his foot down at the 30-yard line, a 30-yard return. Before Vandy snaps it, let's check in with Reese Davis. Reese?
All right, Brad, time for our Dr. Pepper 10 conference update from the SEC. Alabama and Texas A&M on a third and goal. A.J. McCarron is Johnston Fowler. He threw four touchdown passes. Manziel led his team back down. They scored again late. Had an onside kick that Amari Cooper recovered. Alabama gets out of there, 49-42.
So it was everything everybody expected it to be, and maybe then some. Here's a toss to Seymour. Andron Seymour puts his head down and takes the tacklers out of bounds, including Hampton, who he kind of ran over there at the end. 7-yard gain. Vandy's going to go a little tempo here.
Well, it's the way of the world in college football now, and it's very smart.
Curtis Samuels rolls. He might keep this. Fakes the pass. Easily gets the first down and tiptoes out of bounds without getting hit.
Steve Choi, his tight end, was an intended receiver, and as soon as he saw his quarterback start to run, he became a blocker, and his block enabled Carter Samuel to get the first down.
Scrambled out there for 11 yards. And so it's out across the 47-yard line. Brian Kimbrough comes into the Vanderbilt backfield, and now Carter Samuels will come out as a receiver with a Wildcat working here. And it didn't work at all. Another nice play by Kelsey Quarles that time on that defensive front. It's not the only guy on the defensive line, Jadeveon Clowney, that can play. Right. Those other dudes can too.
Well, we've already seen an early sack by Chaz Sutton, and Sutton and Quarles are the two guys that need to step up. If teams are going to run away from Jadeveon Clowney on a consistent basis, then guys on the other side of that defense have to rise up and make plays. They have to make them pay for that philosophy.
So second down and 10. Carter Samuels middle screen, threw it too low. Seymour might have had a little room to work. The blockers were out in front, but it wasn't delivered to him on time or on target. And it's incomplete, third down and long.
And it was Kelsey Quarles again who got pressure. You know, you want to allow quick pressure on a screen, but that time Quarles was very close to Carter Samuels and forced a bad throw.
Three wideouts for Carter Samuels, who was set up in the pistol, and I think we'll end up there eventually. He does. Third and 10. Play action. Pockets collapsing. And down he goes. Second sack of the night.
Well, Kelsey Quarles looks like he's come to play tonight. Did not play very well last week against Georgia. He's been very active. Comes on a little inside tackle stunt. And he gets the sack. Actually, good pressure by he and JT Surratt, both of them working on the inside there.
So another punt coming up from Taylor Hudson. And you hear the chance of Bruce for Ellington. He had a nice return on the last one and got him in Vandy territory the last time he fielded a kick. And this one, he's going to backpedal and take it inside the 10 and got leveled. Chris Moody had to change your mood with a hit like that. 47-yard kick. He timed it perfectly. South Carolina will be in a little bit of a hole inside their 10-yard line. Can't do much better than that on special teams.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by Hampton Hotels. Feel the Hamptonality. And in part by Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy.
Boy, Cocky wanted out of there.
Yeah.
Thought he was on a rotisserie or something inside the cage.
Had his game beak on.
Darius Sims made a great play on the special teams to hit the punt returner Bruce Ellington back at the 7-yard line. So South Carolina does not have good field position this time. They started their last drive there with the Vandy 42. Big difference. Mike Davis hit, bounces off. Nice second effort. Could have lost two, picked up a couple.
Yeah, actually ducked under the tackle and was able to get it forward a little bit. This is an important defensive possession for Vanderbilt. One thing about this season, they're 1-1. but they've been a very slow starting team. They've only scored 3 points in the first quarter of their two games. Now, they've been very good in the second quarter, 56 points in the second quarter, but they can't afford to get behind quickly and early in this one.
Connor Shaw from his own goal line. On a seam route, in and out of the hands of Rory Anderson, his tight end. Nice hit defensively by Wake Forest to make him cough that football up.
And you know what? It was a good hit and a clean hit. So much discussion about the new targeting enforcement of penalties this year. Watch, he goes low. He doesn't go up around the head or neck area. It's a good, solid hit by Herring and jars the ball loose.
So here's a huge third down for the Vandy defense to try to get the ball back. A third down and 7.
Showing a three-man rush, going to drop 8 into coverage here.
Shaw, quick throw, complete, first down. Goes right back to his tight end.
Big target against a zone coverage. And Rory does a nice job. He's in the slot, number 81. He just turns in between two defenders and shows the quarterback his numbers. And that's what you want him to do. You don't want him to drift. You don't want him to be sideways. Show both numbers and let the quarterback throw right in between them.
Anderson's had a little bit of a hamstring problem, but is healthy now. And he might be a lot bigger part of the offense tonight. Here's Bruce Ellington also, likewise. Had a little injury earlier in the season, and he seems fresher tonight. Got about 9 there.
Nice block by Nick Jones, who caught the touchdown in the first Carolina possession. Whenever you throw those wide receiver screens, whether you throw it to the wide guy or the slot guy, the other wide receiver has to get the key block.
Shaw's 5 out of 6 to 5 different receivers so far. Second down and short here, and they're going to throw for it. And it's Ellington again weaving his way through Vandy traffic. Herring, the outside linebacker, made the stop, but they'll move the sticks again.
Well, when we saw South Carolina last week, Brad, offense wasn't their problem. They moved the ball well. They ran it well. Connor Shaw threw it well. They had one turnover, a very costly fumble by Connor Shaw on the Georgia 25-yard line that stopped a very promising drive and led to another score, and Georgia never looked back at that point.
And that was at the end of a first down run by Shaw when he put it on the ground. So first and 10, South Carolina at their own 38-yard line. Shaw again to throw. He's going to air this one out, and is it caught? Nope, no. Broken up. Lost it at the last minute.
Andre Hull is the he is the best corner on this team, and watch him stay with the play. Now, he's beat by Shaq Rowland, but he doesn't give up. He keeps his hands in there, and he's fighting, and he knocks the ball out. You got to possess the ball all the way to the ground, and Hull does a nice job of fighting it out. He never maintains possession because Hull doesn't give up on the play.
Bob Shoup, the defensive coordinator for the Commodores, said that he thinks that guy might be one of the more underrated players in the entire league, especially as a defensive back. Connor Shaw again, deep sideline, wide open, oh, and in and out of the hands of Jeffrey, Shamir Jeffrey. He should have had that.
Reading Connor Shaw's body language after the throw, it looks like there might have been some kind of a miscommunication on the route. It looks like Connor Shaw expected him to go a little bit deeper because that should have been an easy throw and catch. Hall was given a lot of ground out there that time, and that should have been a very easy completion for a first down. Instead, it's 3rd and 10.
8th play of the drive. We'll see if they can convert. Long yardage here from their own 38. They're going to flip it out of the backfield. Same play they did earlier. Mike Davis, same result. Davis inside the 40. He's still on his feet. And down to the 25-yard line. 37-yard play.
Well, again, it has to be a perfect throw. The guy responsible for coverage is a linebacker coming from the inside. Jake Seeland, number 13, making his first start. Took a bad angle to Davis, but the accurate throw by Shaw enabled Davis to catch it without slowing down and get to the corner easily.
So two huge plays by Davis as a receiver so far. Gamecocks started this drive of their own 7. Shaw this time is nailed, but he got the ball to Ellington, and Ellington's got another first down.
Boy, Connor Shaw looks sharp. I mean, he looks on his game. the ball is coming out correctly. It's accurate. He ran early in the first possession, but right now, as a thrower, he is on target. Knows pressure's coming, knows where his outlet receiver is, in this case, Ellington, and gets it to him for a positive gain.
He took a shot at the end of that release, but got it out there to the 11-yard line.
This is the part of the field where he becomes a threat as a runner. In the red zone, quarterback runs, very effective for South Carolina.
They love quarterback draws down here, too. 5:35 remaining in the quarter. South Carolina threatening again. Here comes a quarterback draw. Connor Shaw inside the five. And around the three.
You put two backs in the backfield and you let your quarterback run it, that's two extra blockers. No, so you outman the defense when your quarterback can run like that in the red zone. Very difficult to defend.
Gamecocks can get a first down inside the two.
Now I'm anxious to see if they do everything from the shotgun here or if they go under center some. Last week against Georgia, they had a goal line stand against them. And the fourth down play was an option out of the shotgun. Here they are on first, second down in the gun.
Ellington looks a little confused about where to be lined up. Davis, touchdown, South Carolina.
Ellington looked a little confused, but he did his job, and that is secure the backside. When you run the zone, you have to make sure you block the outside guy. Watch him cut off the backside and allow Davis to cut this all the way back the other way. All he has to do is get in front of his man, which he does, Herring, and Davis is able to get it into the end zone.
Elliott Fry for the point after. All South Carolina here early. Vandy better have an answer for this or it could have got out of hand for him on the road. Well, Mike Davis caught a pass and took it 37 yards to get South Carolina deep in Vandy territory. And then from 4 yards out, he takes it in on the ground. 14-0 South Carolina. Don't have much drives better than their last one. They started their own 7-yard line, went 93 yards and 11 plays in just under 4 minutes. And Mike Davis, who did a lot of the work on that drive as a receiver, as a runner, from 4 yards out for the touchdown. Landon Ard will tee it up. That's Darius Sims, the near man. And Torrey McGaster also back there with him. Sims, 2 yards deep. Out he comes across the 15. Won't make the 20 again. Jadeveon Clowney, we talked about the fact he was a little bit frustrated last week by where he played. And this was his comment in that press conference Holly talked about in the pregame.
It's very frustrating. I told Coach, man, you gotta pick me somewhere else, you know. In the middle, if you want to, I don't know, somewhere I can make some plays, help my team, put us in position to win games. But really, they just ran the ball away from him and took me out of the game tonight.
See where he lines up. He's going to line up in his regular spot. Yeah,
and that's where he's been all night tonight. But Quarles and Sutton have played pretty well so far in the early possessions for South Carolina.
Kimbrough in the backfield with Carter Samuels. It comes up fire and a little bit behind Matthews' intended receiver, incomplete.
Here's part of why it's frustrating for Jadeveon Clowney. It's because, as we see, a little tempo now from Vanderbilt. Teams are more and more going to that. It forces you to line up quickly.
On the ground, Kimbrough found a little bit of running room this time, out to the 26.
It not only forces the defense to line up quickly and show you where a guy like Clowney is, but it also, a lot of teams line up quickly, but they don't necessarily snap it quickly. They line up, they see where the defense is, they look to the sideline, and then they check the play at the line of scrimmage. And it's very easy to see where he is and then call plays that go away from him. Now this is where he needs to make his money on third down when he has a chance to rush the passer.
Third down at 3. There he comes around the corner, and the quarterback, Curtis Samuels, knows that, but he's going to be short by about 2 feet of the first down. Gerald Dixon got some inside pressure.
The guy working against Jadeveon Clowney tonight, number 67, Wesley Johnson, is their best offensive lineman. This is his 41st consecutive start. He's played four different positions. Does a nice job just riding Clowney up the field, knowing that the quarterback is running back inside on that play.
If he plays every game this year, he'll break the Vanderbilt record for most career starts. He's going to be a good player at the next level because of what you said. He can play a lot of different spots. Victor Hampton back as a punt returner this time. Takes a couple steps back and then takes two more steps back. Nice hustle down there by Vandy special teams. Herring made the stop. A loss of four after a 44-yard kick. We thought we'd see Dylan Thompson. Apparently, we will when we come back. Gamecocks with a two-touchdown lead as you look at the South Carolina defensive front there.
Jadeveon Clowney, over the first couple weeks, people have wondered if he takes plays off and doesn't go hard all the time. He went hard on three plays in a row, and then watch him on fourth down go after the punt. I'm surprised he's even in there on the punt team. Punt return team, I should say, but he goes hard after that. I just think he plays a lot harder than people give him credit for, but again, people expect big plays all the time.
Here's Brandon Wilds. They faked the fly sweep and went back to the left side for no gain. We're going to get a gain here from Reese Davis. Reese, what do you got?
Brad, what I have for you is a Taco Bell Live Moss moment, and Ohio State been living Moss early against Cal. No Braxton Miller tonight. Kenny Guyton started. This is Devin Harris's second touchdown catch. The first one was a 90-yarder, 21-7. Buckeyes up in the first.
It was posted, Reese. Dylan Thompson in at quarterback for South Carolina. And he comes up with a quick slant to the tight end, Anderson, and he's got a first down.
Yeah, this is not a surprise for us. Steve told us yesterday that he wanted to play Dylan, that he thought he deserved to play some. It certainly doesn't have anything to do with Connor Shaw being off.
He told us last week we might see him too, but he said Connor's home state, Flowery Branch, Georgia, wanted to give him every opportunity in Athens to try to win that game. And he told us, yeah, I think you'll see Dylan. We're going to throw him in there sometime in the first quarter. And here he is in the first quarter, and he comes up slinging it complete to Demir Byrd. And he's got another first down.
Now, Dylan Thompson doesn't offer the same dual threat capabilities of Connor Shaw, but he can make some throws that Connor Shaw may not make as easily.
Nice block out there by the other wideout to free him for the first down. And so South Carolina sits right at the midfield stripe with a 14-0 lead. Play action. Thompson fires complete wide open as Shaq Rowland first down inside the 35. Pickup of 17 more.
There's evidence right there of his arm strength from the far hash throwing the out to the wide side of the field. This is a long throw and the ball didn't have a whole lot of air under it. Nice shot to the outside to Rowland and moves the chain.
Down to the 33-yard line, first and 10. High snap. Gets it to Brandon Wilds. Weaving his way. Nice run. Didn't look like he was going to get much, but he found a little crease in there and picked up seven.
Vanderbilt is trying to keep their defensive line fresh. They're rotating four at a time. Right now they bring their starters back in.
I don't think they got their guys out. I don't think they got everybody off the field. Nope. I don't see a flag, but there was at least one person that wasn't to the sideline. Now I do see a flag on the far side at about the 28-yard line.
Yeah, they've been trying to substitute all four guys at the same time. And that time, the guys got on the field in time, but not off. Pretty good job by Dylan Thompson getting the ball snapped before they had left the field.
Matt Lafleur is our referee. Here's the call. First penalty of the game.
Offside on the defense. That penalty is declined. The result of the play is first down.
Yeah, I guess they could have called anything there. It was offside. There was too many white jerseys out there. A lot of things happening. At any rate, it moves it in the red zone again at the 17-yard line where it's first and 10 for South Carolina.
Wouldn't be surprised to see Dylan Thompson attack the end zone right here.
He's looking that way. Comes short across the middle to his safety valve, Wilds, and he's got a first and goal.
Good decision. He was looking to Nick Jones, who was running a corner route, which would have been a touchdown. He didn't like what he saw there, and does the smart thing, drops it underneath to Wiles. See, he's looking left, he's looking for Jones, doesn't like it. Dump it off and let Wiles get what he can get.
What he got was down just outside the 3-yard line. Thompson's 5 for 5 throwing the football. First and goal, South Carolina. Ellington in motion and now sets up the same spot he was earlier. And now Dylan Thompson on the ground shows that he can run like Connor Shaw, at least from 3 yards
yes.
out. Touchdown.
And again, a nice job on the backside by Bruce Ellington, the wide receiver who's responsible for the end of the line. He reads it. Dylan Thompson read it, kept it, got it in the end zone.
South Carolina like a machine here for the first 14 and a half minutes of this game. Elliott Fry, point after is good. Just 32 seconds remaining in the first quarter. We told you that Vanderbilt's a slow starting team, but they're good in the second quarter. They better be, because they're getting steamrolled by the Gamecocks right now. 21-0, South Carolina. The most powerful conference in college athletics will live on a new network. Traditions found a new home. SEC Network launches in August 2014. For more info, go to GetSECNetwork.com. The last 7 BCS titles won by teams from the Southeastern Conference, 4 of the last 6 Heismans. And, of course, the team that's won the last 2 and 3 of the last 4, if you missed it, won today in Aggieland. In a thrilling game, Alabama beats Texas A&M. And now here, 2 teams that are trying to keep pace in the SEC East, and one is dominating right now in South Carolina. Gamecocks have won 11 games in each of the last 2 years. That had never happened before, and Steve Spurrier pretty proud of that. He has some mementos that some fans have given him that he's got up in his office stating that very case. 11 wins back-to-back seasons, pretty darn good. Sims from the 1-yard line. This time he's got a little bit of room to work, and the kicker's gonna have to help cut him down. 34-yard return as we check in with Holly.
Well, Todd, you were talking about Jadeveon Clowney playing hard on their last defensive series. He is really battling through this right foot soreness. He arrived at the stadium tonight wearing a walking boot. Somebody told us they saw him on campus in it this week. His foot got stepped on in practice, according to the coaches, last week. He continues to wince on the sideline and keeps telling his guys, man, this is really hurting. He's fighting through it, and the problem is in the stance he gets down in, the right foot is that push-off foot that he's getting that motor from. He's fighting through it.
Thanks, Holly. First down. And it's a wildcat for Kimbrough here. Trying to follow his blockers, even has his hands on his blocker's backside. Picks up 4. Kimbrough, a sophomore out of Memphis, not the biggest guy in the world. 5'8", 185 pounds. James Franklin, we talked about slow starts. They started slow tonight. They have scored at least 21 points in the second quarter in their last 4 games. Vandy fans better hope for some of that tonight, because it's all South Carolina at the end of one. The SEC on ESPN. On a beautiful night in Columbia, South Carolina. Not so pretty if you're a Vanderbilt Commodore right now. They trail 21-0. Slow starts has been the story for them this year, but they've done a great job in quarter number 2. We'll see if they can do that again.
Well, they need to get the ball back in the hands of number 87, Jordan Matthews. They threw it to him early in the first possession. I mean, he is their most dynamic offensive player. Had a big game against South Carolina last year in the Carolina win in Nashville. Had 8 catches, 147 yards, and a touchdown. He's the guy who has a chance to make some big plays, because he's very good after the catch. Second in the nation in yards after the catch the last 2 years behind Marquise Lee of USC.
And that touchdown he had last year was a 78-yarder. Good game coming up following ours. Number 20, Wisconsin. They have pitched a couple shutouts and keep steamrolling people on the ground with James White leading the way. Will Sutton will try to slow him down. Arizona State and Wisconsin. There's the two quarterbacks, Stave and Taylor Kelly. That follows us 10:30 tonight on ESPN.
In this part of the country, everybody talks about Jadeveon Clowney as the best defensive lineman out west. They think Will Sutton's pretty special as well.
So we open the second quarter. Vandy in an eye backfield. And decent gain for Kimbrough. Marcus Roberts, the outside linebacker, made the stop after a pickup of three. They pretty much have to have this third down.
Absolutely. I'm sitting here thinking the same thing. Critical play right now for Vanderbilt. Carter Samuels has got to get it done.
Throws out wide side. Matthews, as Todd said, they got to get it in his hands, and he's got a first down and into South Carolina territory, 47-yard line.
They run their wide receiver screen a little bit different than most people. Most people throw it to the slot guy, and the outside receiver is the blocker. They like to put Matthews out wide, throw the ball to him, and let the slot receiver become the key blocker. They've had a lot of success this season with that little play.
So the Commodores' first trip into Gamecock territory, just inside the 47-yard line. Carter Samuels in the gun. Scans the field, comes across the middle into some tight coverage, and it's incomplete, intended for Shoy, the tight end. Kind of a dangerous throw. There was two guys on number 81. He tried to tuck it in there. It'll bring up second down and 10.
And now it's second down and 10. They take Shoy out, and they bring in the extra lineman, Andrew Jelps, number 50, who they'll line up in the tight end position. And again, this has been a heavy run formation for them. So South Carolina's strategy against this, kind of load the box, blitz it, anticipating run more than pass.
They give it off to Kimbrough. He stood up by Jadeveon Clowney, and then he gets help from his friends. Got about 3 yards out of it. James Franklin said, come on, let's go. This time they run Jadeveon's way.
Yep. And you see their best lineman working on him. Has a hold of the jersey. You know, sometimes you got to hold Superman.
Look out. Avoided a sack from Chaz Sutton, did Carter Samuels, and then landed on his backside.
Well, Sutton chased the quarterback, and Clowney played the screen. Watch Jadeveon read it and go out on the screen, and Sutton went after the quarterback. Both defensive ends lined up on the same side that time, and both of them did their job beautifully.
So they did convert one third down, but now they find themselves in a fourth down and have to punt again. Fourth down and 7. Hudson, knuckleball kick. This one's going to be a good one, though. It'll go out around the 7 or 8 yard line. So for the second time tonight, South Carolina be inside their own 10. The last time they went 93 yards for a touchdown. .13:26 remaining till halftime. Time for our
Aflac
trivia question. In the history of the Associated Press Bowl since 1936, Commodores have only defeated two ranked teams in true road games. Who are they? I'll give you some time on that one. Second time tonight, South Carolina will be inside its own 10-yard line to start a drive. They started at the 7 earlier and capped off a 93-yard march in 11 plays. This time they'll be at the 8. And it'll be Connor Shaw coming back in at quarterback.
Yeah, that drive, they went 93 yards. They converted a huge third down play, a pass from Connor Shaw to the tight end Rory Anderson that really got him out of there and got him going.
13 out of 16 between the two quarterbacks so far in the first half. And Shaw rolls into his own end zone, loads it up, and now pulls it down. Wanted to throw, but he gets what he can, which is about 4 yards. Before Kyle Westman brings him down.
and a good decision. They had a deep route to Demir Byrd, who's the fastest of the wide receivers. Vanderbilt didn't bite on it, and he made the solid decision to just become a runner and turn it into a 5-yard gain.
Mike Davis checks back in. Ellington, the slot man. Anderson, the tight end, with three receivers to the near side for Shaw on second down and 5. Blitz coming. Shaw lobs a middle screen to Davis, and he's got room to work. Mike Davis all the way out to the 30-yard line. 18 yards. Looked like almost a perfect play right there.
Yeah. Really nice job by the tight end, Rory Anderson, number 81, who was lined up in the slot. He's going to come right into the middle and get a key block on the linebacker, 13. Watch that. There's the key block, and Mike Davis did a nice job of reading the blocks and getting the ball upfield.
And now it's Ellington on a slip screen on the outside. We only got a couple. Steven Clark holding on for dear life over there on the corner.
Well, the last 4 or 5 years, Vanderbilt has played very competitively against South Carolina. And South Carolina has not scored a lot of points against them. But tonight, they don't seem to have any answers for Carolina's offense. They have got it going on, the run and the pass, both quarterbacks making good decisions, and they really have this Vanderbilt defense off balance.
Second down at 7 from the 33. Connor Shaw loads and fires deep sideline, incomplete, intended for Anderson. And he wanted Anderson to get a little closer to that sideline and try to hit him on the back shoulder, incomplete. So brings up third down and long. And that hasn't been a problem so far for South Carolina tonight. Not yet.
I think if you're Bob Shoup, defensive coordinator, you got to go after Connor Shaw here. Even though he's a threat to run, I don't think you want to play zone defense because he's been on with his accuracy and decision making. I think you go after him.
Wilds is behind Shaw in the pistol set. Shaq Rowland and Ellington one way, Anderson and Nick Jones the other. Shaw is going to air it out long for Ellington. Over the shoulder catch, perfectly thrown. And he beats the freshman Darius Sims all the way down to the 30-yard line.
See, they like to run that fade route from the slot because that gives them a lot of room to throw over the outside shoulder. Got a lot of space between that route and the sideline. Steve always loved that route in Florida with his quarterback and wide receivers. Brought that same concept here to South Carolina, and you can't throw it much better than that.
Second time Shaw's thrown a 37-yard completion. That one was a long ball. The other one was to Mike Davis on the swing pass, and it's got him down inside the 30 as they mark it at the 28. Shaw again over the middle, and this is Wilds near the 22 for number 22. Jake Seelan, the middle linebacker, made the stop. Seelan in there because Chase Garnham, the normal middle linebacker, has a right leg injury. He's been in a cast this week. So Seelan's, who's a young guy at Tucker, Georgia, good player, but doesn't have the kind of experience they had from the other guy. And there he is. I'm not quite sure when he's going to be back. Flags down.
Oh, illegal substitution on the offense. 12 men in the huddle. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
First penalty against the Gamecocks.
There's no timeout.
They're moving the ball well enough with 11. They don't need 12.
That's for sure. So the clock stopped, 10:43, and again, Connor Shaw has been nearly perfect. He's had a couple of passes that could have been caught.
Yeah.
I mean, between he and Dylan Thompson, ball hasn't touched the ground very often.
Well, and the problem for Vanderbilt
please
is
reset the game clock to 10:55 on the game clock, please. 10:55 on the game clock.
They've not been able to make him uncomfortable at all. They haven't got enough pressure on him to make him uncomfortable in the pocket or to make some bad decisions, and so his accuracy has been on point.
Mike Davis flushes out of the backfield up as a wide receiver on the right, and now Shaw's going to take off. Inside run. Got a pretty good game before Walker May wrapped up his ankles. And brings up third down. Third down at 7. They've been in this situation earlier in this drive. They need to get down to the 18-yard line for a first down. South Carolina 4.5 minutes more time of possession, but they've used that possession time beautifully. 283 yards already. Third down at 7. Little stunt on the front line for Vandy. Didn't matter. Perfect throw. Bruce Ellington, touchdown. 26-yard strike. Shaw to Ellington this time.
You know a quarterback's feeling it when he feels he can throw a ball in between two tight defenders. The corner and the safety had great coverage on Ellington, but the ball goes right between the two white shirts. That is a quarterback feeling pretty good tonight.
Extra point is good. The Gamecock had a 93-yard scoring march earlier. This time they go 92 yards and 8 plays in a little over 3 minutes. And Cutter Shaw throws a strike to Bruce Ellington. 28-0 Gamecocks.
ESPN College Football Primetime. Brought to you by the all-new Sierra. Designed and engineered by GMC. That's professional grade. And Aflac, official partner of the Heisman Trophy.
As the fountain at 5 points, Vandy wishes Carolina only had 5 points, 28-0.
Well, the execution level for South Carolina has been beautiful. Now, Darius Sims is going to come on a blitz, but I want you to watch. Look at the eyes right here of Wilds. He is seeing the blitz. That's his responsibility to move across the formation and pick it up. Connor Shaw knows he has a linebacker running underneath the coverage. Doesn't matter. Sticks it right in between two defenders. But the execution of South Carolina has been spectacular.
Ellington, career high in receptions. We expected him to be a big part of their offense. With some knick-knack injuries earlier, he hadn't been. And a second ago, the kickoff. Down to Sims around the 5. And again, barely gets to the 20-yard line. And we got a Wake Forest player down. It's Harding Harper, I think, a backup middle linebacker. If I said Wake Forest, I apologize. Vanderbilt. So we'll check on Harding Harper with just under 10 minutes to go when we come back. Harding Harper on the sideline, redshirt freshman out of Montgomery, Alabama, on the kickoff return team. He just sort of took a weird step on his own. I don't think he was hit by anybody. They're working on his left knee right now. So they've already are thin at the middle linebacker position, and it just got thinner. Commodores on offense in the Wildcat. And this time, it works pretty well. For Jerron Seymour, who picked up 8. And we check in with Reese Davis. Reese.
All right, Brad, time for Sports Center right now, brought to you by Ally Bank. Baseball coming down the gut of the season. Red Sox beat the Yankees 5-1. John Lester went 8, gave up just 3 hits and a run. That dealt the Yankees a wild card blow to their hopes. 2.5 back now. LSU on ESPNU against Kent State up 24-7. That's Jeremy Hill going in for the touchdown.
Full house backfield. Carter Samuels wants to throw. He's flushed out of the pocket. Got away from the first guy and the second. Not the third. Go lightly. Got him. Third sack of the night for South Carolina.
A lot of substitutes in on the first two plays for South Carolina. They get good pressure there. Excellent coverage downfield. Carter Samuels had enough time to throw. Couldn't find anybody open, had to reload. And as you mentioned, got away from the first two would-be tacklers, but not go lightly.
So now you've got third down and 12. And only one third down conversion for Vanderbilt so far tonight. Not much of a play fake. Carter Samuels is going to try to get it on his own, and he won't. Jimmy Legree made the stop, and it's punting time again for the Commodores.
Last week in Athens, this South Carolina defense gave up 537 yards. It was the most in a game since 2007 when they gave up 651 to Arkansas. A much different looking defense tonight. I mean, they are on point, and as Steve Spurrier told us, Vanderbilt only 48 yards of offense, and he said, hey, we just got to get them lined up faster and then just go play.
And they have third three and out for Vanderbilt now, and they've got a punt again. Hudson's kick, ooh, a dandy. Over the shoulder catch attempted by Ellington. He dropped it. And now he picks it up at the two. Starting to come the other way and dropped. And it's Sims again on the punt return team. And we might have a flag before this play's over. The end of the play, and it's still going on.
It's going to go against Vanderbilt, I'm pretty sure. Well, now we've got one on both teams. So not very smart by either player.
See if we have one or two.
The first one was clearly on Vanderbilt and would have hurt there. You know, they had him pinned down inside the 10 again, but it was going to bring it out. But then I think the second flag was against South Carolina.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conducts against each team. A number 28 white and number three on the South Carolina. By rule, those penalties offset. First down. Timeout.
So a 75-yard punt. Penalties going either way. Offset the situation. And Ellington dropped right there. All Gamecocks right now. 28 to nothing. All South Carolina right now. Earlier we asked you in the history of the AP poll on our Aflac trivia question, the Commodores have only defeated two ranked teams in true road games. Who are they? Georgia in 2006, and then the following year, South Carolina in 2007. Right now, Vanderbilt's in a load of trouble here, and it doesn't matter where South Carolina starts their offensive drives, at least so far it hasn't, but this time Mike Davis has stopped for only a one-yard gain by Kenny Ladler.
And Dylan Thomas in for another possession.
Right now, South Carolina is on pace for 900 yards of offense. They've had 34 plays, no negative yardage. Only six plays with no gain, four incompletions. It's been almost perfect.
Yep. Well, Steve was so disappointed because in both of the first two games, they didn't run more than 60 plays.
And here comes Dylan Thompson running at quarterback. He's already scored on the ground tonight, and he almost got a first down there.
I just think it's amazing when you consider what Steve Spurrier's done here. I mean, we all know the success he had at Florida, but he literally changed the culture here in Columbia as well.
First down. Westman makes the stop.
It used to be when you talked about the power in the SEC East, it was Tennessee and Florida, and then it was Tennessee, Florida, and Georgia. And now it's Georgia, Florida, and South Carolina. Tennessee's fighting to get back into fray. Of course, Vanderbilt has made improvements. Kentucky with a new coach in Mark Stoops. Missouri in the East now, but South Carolina, a legitimate power in the East.
Here's a throw out, completes. Went Don Smith, and he's got about 9 yards. Holly?
Well, I checked with the Columbia Chamber of Commerce because there's just more of a buzz here in downtown with businesses, people coming into town. And they said the university have done a study that there is about a $6 million boost every time they have a home game here in the community. Winning football equals better business, more excitement, and Steve Spurrier certainly brought that here to Columbia.
Steve was telling us that a few years ago when he first got here, they were playing number two Auburn at the time. As Davis rips off another first down run out across the 35-yard line. As Steve was telling us, he said they were playing number two Auburn and they lost 24-17, even though they were throwing, trying to get a touchdown on the final play. And when they went to the locker room, all the fans here, Williams-Brice, were clapping.
Yeah.
And he got on his radio show and said, please don't ever do that again. We're not into moral victories. We want to build a program. And obviously he's built one where he's the winningest coach in two different schools, Florida and here. And only Bear Bryant can make that claim. Keep it on the ground with Davis off the right tackle again. And right now they're just gashing the Commodores defense.
Well, Holly mentioned the economic impact. I'll tell you another study that would be interesting that I think is equally true. Winning football means more contributions of alumni to your university and more applications of students that want to go to school at your university.
Right.
It has a powerful effect on a whole community and a university.
They talked about what Johnny Manziel did as far as enrollment at Texas A&M, and same can be said about kids here in Columbia. Incomplete pass this time. South Carolina has an enrollment of over 31,000. And, of course, Vanderbilt only around 6,800. This place has been packed pretty much every time they played, as they have won four straight against Vanderbilt. As I mentioned earlier, 11 wins in each of the last 2 years, and their home winning streak is third longest. And Georgia got that 13 by beating South Carolina between the hedges last week. So three wide outs for Thompson on a third and five, and they're going to run some option here. And he's going to keep it, and he's going to get the first down.
Yeah, he must not have liked what I said about him not being the same dual threat guy that Connor Shaw. I think that option is just an automatic play against a certain defensive look. It's not determined that he's going to keep it or pitch it, but it's wide open. And when in doubt, don't pitch it out. Good decision, and got the first down easily.
So the junior out of Boiling Springs, South Carolina, has had three big runs tonight, one for a touchdown. And now the ninth play of the drive, and they're back in Vanderbilt territory. This one's batted up in the air. He caught his own tipped ball. So he's got an attempt and a completion himself.
It would have been second and 10 on an incompletion, and it's second and 10 on a completion. So blitz. Andre Hall got a hand on the football. And at that point, Thompson has the decision, either catch it or just bat it down to the ground. It's second and 10 virtually either way.
Actually lost a little bit, and that would be the first negative play of the night. Now they go positive play, and it's intercepted. There's a negative play, and a nice play by Stephen Clark. Interception on the run down the sideline, still on his feet. Clark bouncing off, guys, inside the 20. Clark, he's all the way down to the one-yard line. What a run back on the interception. And there goes the visor.
This is a beautiful play by Stephen Clark, because he left his man. Watch Stephen Clark leave the outside receiver and peel back for Ellington. He felt the throw coming underneath. He left his man and went and picked the ball off in front of Ellington, and then made a nifty run back after the interception.
That was a 69-yard return down to the South Carolina one-yard line. Got some nice blocking from his teammates and almost scored. Wild saved the touchdown. And slow to go off the field, Marshall, one of the captains, Javon Marshall, senior safety.
Well, this is where Vanderbilt not only brings in a sixth offensive lineman, but a seventh. They bring in their super jumbo lineup. They bring in Jelks, number 50, and also Spencer Pulley.
And they go with a wildcat. Seymour will take the snap, and he'll score standing up. So they really take advantage of the turnover in a hurry. One play, 1 yard, one touchdown.
That extra lineman they bring in, Jelks, gets a nice block. Watch number 50 on the end of the line as the tight end seals the linebacker. The fullback, Fitz Lassing, 38, does a nice job and an easy touchdown. And they had to capitalize at some point. And they did right there.
Terry Spear in for the point after. And the extra point up and good. So Vanderbilt was in dire need of making a big play, and they finally got one. For James Franklin and company, now it's 28-7 as we check in this week with Todd's Taste of the Town.
Let me start by saying there are some awesome food choices in Columbia, South Carolina. But when I hear the words great burger, a light goes off for me. And here in the Five Points area, there's a place that opened in 2009 that serves up some of the best burgers in the state. It's called Paulie's Front Porch. All the meat is ground fresh each morning, and the burgers are named for coastal areas of South Carolina. Now, I went with the Isle of Palms burger, which features some house-made pimento cheese, jalapeno bacon, and I added some grilled onions. Throw in some hand-cut fries, and can it get any better than this? I don't think so.
Now, that looks exceptional. I want to tell you something after the kick, though.
All right.
3:38 remaining in the half.
You like a good burger, right?
I wish I'd have gone with you because that looks like it's one of the best I've ever seen. Gary Spear to kick. And Sean Carson back deep. At the goal line, dropped the ball. Picked it up on one hop. And he's going to get leveled at about the 12-yard line. Just wanted to say one thing to you, partner.
Yeah.
You got a little bit something right about there.
Yeah,
you know,
I know.
You need a napkin?
I know. I didn't realize that, you know. They caught me. My man Dave Earnhardt, the camera guy, didn't get off me soon enough. I didn't know
how you got your mouth around that thing. Let's be honest.
I'm a professional.
You are professional.
I'm a professional. That's what I do. But, I mean, hey, it was another great place.
Yep.
Paulie's Front Porch. Amanda Steen was the manager there, took care of us, and we're off to a rousing start.
Yep.
You know, it's fun to have the segment back again this year.
Remember, he is a professional. Don't try that at
That's
home.
That's right.
Yeah.
Don't try it at home.
And Todd's Taste of the Town book is out. He was signing books outside the stadium here today. Connor Shaw back in the quarterback at the 13-yard line. Now with a 28-7 ball game. And he gives it to number 28. And Mike Davis, boy, he's had some tough runs. He's had long runs both of the first 2 weeks, a 75-yard touchdown, and then another 75-yard run we saw last week. And he gets some tough yardage as well. 5'9 senior from Lathonia, Georgia. His brother James played at Clemson. Clemson's number two all-time leading rusher, in fact. And he's the first running back in South Carolina history to have back-to-back games with 75-yard runs.
Yeah, and I don't think Mike Davis is going to make people around here forget about Marcus Lattimore.
No.
But he's making the sting of losing Lattimore a lot less painful because he has really played well here early in the season and played well in substitution last year.
And George Rogers, the Heisman Trophy winner in 80. He and Jadeveon Clowney, ooh, the official took a bad spill over there by the first down marker. Hopefully he's okay. Herring made the stop on Shaq Rowland. And we'll wait to see if our official is going to be all right. The trainers from both teams come flying out there. He was right at the first down stick and trying to get out of the way and backpedaling. And
well, we had the official and we had the chain gang.
Right.
They couldn't get that out of the way. He couldn't get out of the way. I think he tripped over that and he got hit. Hope he's okay.
Not only taking one in the knees, but also kind of banging his head on the turf when he hit. We'll check on our official for sure when we come back.
I'm Reese Davis coming up on the Buick Halftime Report. We went to an SEC showdown in College Station, and all of a sudden, an old game from the old WAC broke out. Alabama and Texas A&M in a wild one. Both Notre Dame just starting against Purdue in commercial break right now, and Michigan perhaps with a little hangover from last week. Mark and Lou join me. We'll see you in just a few minutes on the Buick Halftime Report.
All right, Reese, thanks. Back here in Columbia, it's the headlinesman Gus Morris, who is still down. And again, as we said, not only was he trying to mark the line, but the chain gang was right there too. And Holly, I think, is down in that area. Holly?
Well, guys, I'll give you an update on his injury, but just to let you know, they do have an alternate official here. Mark Curls has run into the game. An interesting thing with these SEC officials, they're wearing these battery pack microphone systems, so they all have a wireless headset to communicate with each other. Mark Curls, the alternate, has been listening to the guys communicate for the whole game. So even though he's the alternate, he's been standing on the sideline. He's completely locked in, dialed in to what's been going in the game because he's been listening to all the guys communicate with each other. I will give you an injury update on Gus as soon as I'm available.
Okay, Holly, thanks. You see referee Matt Leffler's hovering around there. All the officials have been over there worrying about their partner. The guys close friends in a group working together. Brent Sowles, the umpire, line judges. Michael Shirley, Bobby Abels is a field judge, side judges James Carter, the back judge is Rich Martinez. The alternate is, Holly already said, you saw Mark Curls, and the guy that we're worried about is the head linesman, Gus Morris, the third. Right. And they got him up and gonna get him on the cart. You don't see as many of those as you do the umpire. Yeah. The umpire gets in the line of fire a lot, and that was a tough one because not only did Gus take it in the knee area, but I know that he hit his head when he landed.
And I think that's the issue right here. I think that's why they're taking extra precaution and taking their time. And obviously, those guys in the striped shirts are the only ones out there with no equipment on.
Yeah.
And unprotected in that respect.
And again, trying to make a play, one guy trying to get a first down, one guy trying to prevent it, and one guy trying to get out of the way and officiate it and keep his eyes spotted on where they were going to go out of bounds.
Yeah, I think that when he hit his head on the back of the ground, that's what did it for him. You can see he's still definitely feeling the effects of that.
All right, Gus. And he'll get a nice ovation as they take him off on the cart here. Normally, you don't get a good ovation if you're an official. So we're going to wish him the best and hope he feels better later or better quickly. Meanwhile, the alternate takes the field. They bring out the chains to mark the ball, and apparently it's going to be short of the first down by about the length of the football. So that means third down. The good thing is when something happens to you, there's almost no better place to be other than a hospital than a football stadium.
Right.
And the Gamecocks will take the field again. That's third down and about a foot. With a big lead, with a little over 2.5 to go in the half. Connor Shaw will come up under center, as Todd said. And short yardage last week against Georgia, they couldn't do this. This time they do. And if they'd have done that last week, they might have scored a touchdown.
Yeah, they might have. It was a two-score game at that point, and Steve Spurrier elected to go for the touchdown on 4th and 1. Not sure if he would get that close again, and they were stopped. And Georgia was able to run out the clock then from that point on.
South Carolina's perfect on third down tonight. 7 for 7. A little bit of a high snap, but he gets the handoff, fakes the handoff to Davis, keeps it himself, and not much of a gain. This is the play we were talking about last week.
And they got down in there, first started with pressure, and Connor Shaw had to run. Then a designed quarterback draw, which they love in the red zone.
And Davis comes up about a yard shy.
Yep.
Here's the option we were talking about. That one didn't have a chance either.
We talked to Steve about that, and you know, taking that ball off the line of scrimmage with the shotgun. He said, yeah, we're going to change that.
Wow, not a nice run by Davis. That had a little bit of everything. Looked like he was going to lose about 3. Spin move, broken tackle, pick up 8.
Well, he runs hard, you know, and they substitute Wilds enough for him that they keep both these guys fresh. And they both run with power and strength.
See if they can stay perfect on third down. Yep. And then some. Out to the 41-yard line.
Now obviously, you have some fatigue working with this Vanderbilt defense. This is a lot of offensive plays in the first half that they've been out there. Mike Davis running with low center of gravity, got good pad level, and hard to tackle.
Under a minute to go in the half. Connor Shaw deep in the middle, wide open, ball is out. Caught and then recovered. Nick Jones made the catch. It came flying out and Ellington covers it.
Well, they may end up taking a look at this to see if it's a completion. I think it was. Secures it, then he got hit. It's close. Yeah, they're gonna take a look at it.
And Connor Shaw tried to get a snap before the replay, but they stopped play there.
But the point is, Connor Shaw has been right on point throwing the football. The only thing that Nick Jones did there,
the previous play is under further review.
The only thing that Nick Jones did there was he took his eyes off the ball at the last minute to see where Ladler was, the safety, coming at him. Watch. Took his eyes off the football at the last minute, and that might have been what prevented him from securing the catch.
So the replay officials, the only guy I didn't mention a little bit earlier, John Bibles, the replay official tonight. There's another angle, and the ball comes squirting out of there.
It was ruled a catch on the field, so it has to be indisputable evidence to overturn that call. Catch and a fumble recovered by South Carolina.
If it's a catch and it stays, Connor Shaw's 15 out of 19 with two drop passes. Yes.
It looked like to me that he did catch the football, but he didn't tuck it away. He caught it and kept it out away from his body, and Ladler was able to get his shoulder pad on the football. But we'll see what they call.
With the exception of the interception thrown by Dylan Thompson that Vanderbilt took all the way down to the 1 yard line, it's been South Carolina with a near perfect performance on both sides of the ball. Just that one miscue.
They ran 59 offensive plays in the opener against North Carolina, 61 plays last week in the loss in Athens to Georgia. So far in the first half, 50 plays. So they're well on their way to their most productive offensive game by far.
The truck tells me Steve Landis is the replay official tonight, not John Bible. He's filling in for John. So we await what Steve's got to say and what Matt will tell us, our referee. Steve's had a pretty good night with the exception of that one drop kick of the visor on the interception. And this one's taken a while.
I wonder if he gets grass stained on the visor, if he has to wear a new one the next week. Or maybe even at halftime if he's got another one in there for him.
Backup visor?
Yeah.
Yeah.
His offense looks sharp, that's for sure.
That's why we got a big smile on both quarterbacks' faces. Both Shaw and Thompson have been sharp tonight through the air and on the ground, including Dylan Thompson with the touchdown run. Well, this one is close enough that it's taking a long time. South Carolina just under 400 yards of offense in the first half. And that's usually what you get for a game, much less a half.
Yeah.
I'm with you, Steve. I just made the same gesture right up here to Todd. Let's go.
What's taking so long? Well, part of his thing is, you know, go ahead and make the call. I just don't want you to slow down the tempo or the rhythm of our offense, because right now we're heading towards another score whether we get this play or not.
There's about 6 minutes of our life we'll never get back.
After further review, it was an incomplete pass. It will be second and 10 on the 40-yard line. Gamecock operator, please reset the game clock to 51 seconds, please. 51 seconds.
So incomplete pass. And it goes back to 51 seconds.
Beautiful throw. Nice play by Ladler getting in there and making contact with the football. And Nick Jones just not able to secure it.
And as Todd said, you talk about slowing momentum down. Gamecocks offense has been standing over on the sideline for that entire time, trying to keep that pace going that they had going.
They're going to try to score one more time. They've got 50 seconds and all three timeouts.
Shaw runs up the middle. He'll be dragged down by Baron Dixon. Only got a couple of yards, so it's going to be third down and eight.
Pretty athletic play by Baron Dixon, because Connor Shaw usually able to slip away from plays like that.
Timeout, Vanderbilt. That's the first charge timeout of the half.
So Vandy takes a timeout with 39 seconds. They'd like to get the ball back, but the way the third down conversions have been going for South Carolina,
timeout.
They might never see it, no matter how many timeouts they might call. One of the sport's greatest rivalries continues with a pivotal matchup. Yankees trying to keep their wild card hopes alive. They'll take on the East leading Red Sox. Yankees and Red Sox tomorrow night, 8 o'clock on ESPN and live on Watch ESPN. That's some pretty good company. Buchholz is joining there.
Tell you what, it's an exciting American League wild card race right now.
You were into it last night at dinner, man.
My Cleveland Indians are they're right there in the thick of things. Have a nice schedule the rest of the way out. Hopefully we can see them make it in there.
Well, perfect on third down to this point. Can Connor Shaw pick up another one? Third down and a long eight. Three wideouts to his right. He looks that way. Now comes back and going deep in the middle and overshot Shaq Rowland. And there's the first third down attempt that is not a completion for Shaw. So the timeout by Vandy was good, because they're going to force the Gamecocks to kick first time tonight. Jonathan Krause, who's a fine punt returner, waiting back at the 15-yard line on the kick from Tyler Hall. Kicks it to the far side, trying to keep it out of the returner's hands, and he put it in a great spot. And Sidney Rhodes was in a great spot. 43-yard punt and a perfect hit to make the stop on special teams. Speaking of perfect, not quite perfect, but very close, Todd.
He's been very sharp. You know, he always has been a guy who makes good decisions. There's a toughness about him. He doesn't mind running the football. But tonight, what's really stood out is the accuracy throwing the football. He has been right on point, whether he's throwing down the field, swing passes to Mike Davis. He has had a beautiful first half.
Carter Samuels in the shotgun. Looks left, comes back on the slant, and they finally get it to the big play guy, Jordan Matthews. And Matthews has it across the 45 to the 46, 30-yard pickup. They've got two timeouts left. They move the sticks with 21 seconds remaining. They don't have the sticks set yet, but they're going to snap it. Carter Samuels again, flushed out of the pocket. Throws near side and tiptoeing out of bounds is Matthews again. So two quick throws to their all SEC wide receiver.
Really enjoyed visiting with him yesterday. Coming out of high school, he had no scholarship offers. Madison Academy in Alabama, small school. And then there was a late decommit at Vanderbilt, and they offered him a scholarship, and he's become one of the outstanding receivers in this league.
And this one's caught by Jonathan Krause, out of bounds with 5 seconds left. 10-yard pickup. They've got one of the better kickers in the country. And let's see if they give him a shot. They will. Gary Speer is on the Groza list. It was a year ago.
30-second timeout.
All-SEC performer last year.
What are we looking at here, a 57-yard kick?
He had a school record 20 field goals made out of 24 attempts. It's going to be about 54. Boy, if they get three out of this, it would be huge.
Yeah.
Considering it looked like South Carolina was going to score more points before halftime, but then on the review, that Jones, what we thought was a completion, was taken out. Quarterback comparison tonight, well, it hasn't been A great night for Austin Carter Samuels, but he hasn't been on the field very long.
No, and really they've been a little bit absent of the running game, which they have not had much of this entire season so far. Coming into the ball game, only averaging 150 yards a game rushing, and that was most of it against Austin Peay last week.
The final play of the half, Carey Spears going to try a 54-yard field goal. From the right hash, trying to get Vandy three more points before the break, and you talk about a nice kick. How about that? And that's why he's on the Groza list.
End of the first half.
10 unanswered Vanderbilt points in the final 3.5 minutes of the half, including a 54-yard field goal as we check in with Holly.
Well, Coach, you guys got over 50 plays offensively just in this half alone. What was it like to have your offense out there and get some momentum?
Yeah, we played pretty well until we gave them that one. And now they got 10 points, so but we'll regroup and try to play like we did early in the game.
Your defense needed to improve this week. How do you assess their improvement?
Oh, we played pretty well. We haven't given up much. Played very well.
Guys want me to ask you, when you get grass stains on your visor, do you change it out at the half?
Yeah, I throw these things now. I don't throw my visor.
He didn't throw his visor. He kicked it. I guess that's a difference for him. Well, their defense did play brilliantly. They only gave up a 1-yard touchdown run and then a 54-yard field goal. But Vandy's in it now at halftime, 28-10, as we go to the Buick halftime report with Reese and the guys. You're watching the SEC on ESPN.
The Gamecocks hoping to put a little flair back in their game tonight.
Carter Samuels got a man right in his face. Down he goes. Jog the shotgun, goes to the end zone. Touchdown. Davis, touchdown, South Carolina. And now Dylan Thompson on the ground. Shows that he can run like Connor Shaw. Shaw again.
Perfect throw, Bruce Ellington, touchdown.
You talk about a nice kick. How about that? Vandy's in it now. And we welcome you back to ESPN's College Football Primetime presented by Hampton Hotels. We take a look at our first half statistics, dominated by South Carolina. 52 plays, almost 400 yards of offense. They only missed one third down conversion. They had the ball 9.5 minutes more than Vanderbilt. But Vandy with 10 late points in the last 3 minutes, 38 seconds, including a 54-yard field goal by that guy. And so we do have a ball game to start the second half. Sean Carson waits back deep for South Carolina as we open up the third quarter. Carson will backpedal and just watch this one go out the back of the end zone. So 28-10 as we start the third. We welcome you back to Williams-Brice Stadium. Brad Nessler and Todd Blackledge. Partner, that last 3 minutes and 38 seconds, I think, is pretty important.
Yeah, well, the only bad thing South Carolina did was the turnover by Dylan Thompson. The interception was returned down to the 1-yard line. So Vanderbilt capitalized on that. But the big question in the second half, can they do anything on defense? Yep. They have not come near slowing down South Carolina other than that interception. And I think Bob Shoup's going to have to do something different. I don't think they can play base defense. I think they're going to have to try to crowd the line of scrimmage, take some chances, and try to get some pressure on Connor Shaw, because he's been almost unstoppable when he's been in the game.
Well, we'll see what they do to open up from the 25. Four wide receiver group for Connor Shaw has had a big night, and he comes up throwing on first down, and he's got another completion out this time to his tight end Anderson as we check in with Holly.
James Franklin said their biggest issue is up front. He said their offensive line is killing us. They're just protecting too well. We're not getting any pressure on the quarterback. We've got to get the ball out of the quarterback's hands. He said for us offensively, our line is not sustaining blocks. He said we can't get any momentum. We've got to get the ball to 87. He's our best player. We've got to do a better job up front.
They did that a couple of times late in that second quarter to help set up the field goal. But you're right, Holly, they haven't gotten to Shaw as Davis runs for another first down. And he's just been a horse tonight. He hasn't had any big runs, but he's up around 50 yards on the ground. And he's had some big receptions out of the backfield as well. Through 2.5 games now, South Carolina's only given up 3 sacks, none tonight. And there's the numbers on Mike as he got to 51 on his 10th carry. Looks like he was hobbling a little bit after that last one. But he did get a first down at the 36-yard line. Shaw, deep sideline, wide open, Shaq rolling. And he steps out of bounds with another first down. And a pickup, 19 more.
Run and pass. They've had balance all night. Pretty big cushion by Andre Hall. Nice job by Roland pushing him down the field and then breaking it out on the comeback route. And again, good timing, good accuracy by Connor Shaw. And we've seen that the entire game.
Group of three to the near side, but they keep it on the ground. And now Davis cuts it outside. He's got Ellington as a blocker out in front. Gets inside the 40 and another good run by Mike Davis.
Just instinct, because that play was bottled up. I mean, he was hit in the backfield, but he wasn't wrapped up in the backfield. So he just bounced and found some space. Got knocked back a couple steps and then got it to the perimeter and turned it into a positive game.
Picked up eight when it didn't look like there was anything. Second down and two. Two tight ends set here. Davis trying to cut back, and this time Commodores are waiting for him. Very little gain. Jake Seeland was the first guy to make contact, and then he got help from his friends. And Mike's going to have to clear a big hunk of Williams-Brice Stadium out of his face mask. Should get a little help from his friends on that. He doesn't know it's there. Third down and a yard coming up. Nice balance of run and pass for South Carolina. Davis trying to bulldoze in there. It's going to be really close.
You know, Holly mentioned that James Franklin said the offensive line of South Carolina has just been really having their way with Vanderbilt's defense. We should mention, for the second week in a row, South Carolina is playing with their backup center, Clayton Stadnick, number 54, in for the injured Cody Waldrop, who has a right foot injury. Could not play last week in Athens. Didn't play this week either. And the one thing I've noticed, Stadnick has been better with the shotgun snaps than he was a week ago.
And on fourth and less than a yard, Shaw takes it himself as he took the snap under center, and he's going to have the first down.
Ran right behind Clayton Stadnick.
Yes, he did. And Connor Shaw gives the first down sign in case the official wasn't going to. He's had some nice runs in his career. He's had some tough runs in his career, and that was one of them.
See, this is where Steve Spurrier, historically, after you get it on fourth and one, go play action here and maybe take a shot for a big play.
Eighth play of the drive to open up the third quarter. Flaring it out to the tight end, Adams, and he's got a first down. That's the backup tight end, pickup of 12. And he, like Rory Anderson, a big target, 6'6", yeah. 237 pounds.
And they're athletic. You know, this is a nice job. They took the two outside receivers to run off the coverage. Shaq Rowland comes back with a nice block. And you go underneath to the tight ends. And both Adams and Anderson are athletic guys.
Brandon Wilds now in the backfield with Connor Shaw in the shotgun. They fake it to him, and now Shaw's going to take off and get back to the line of scrimmage. That's it. Might have even lost a little bit. Adam Butler and Larry Franklin made the hit. Well, against North Carolina, 59 plays over 400 yards. Tonight they already have 61. They had 61 in the whole game against Georgia. And they're racking up yardage. As we told you, they're on pace for 800 yards of offense.
And they're not running hurry-up tempo either. No. They're just being very productive every time they have the football. I mean, they're still huddling. They're not going tempo offense. They're just productive.
They shift out of the lineup they had when they were in a pistol set. And now both running backs come out of the backfield as Connor Shaw threw it to nobody. And flag down. I think maybe going to have a roughing the passer on Weatherly.
Either that or holding, thrown in the same area.
You're right, Todd. Hold it. Corey Robinson was trying to keep Weatherly off of holding. Connor Shaw.
On the offense, number 53, 10-yard penalty. Repeat, second down.
Big left tackle, 6'8", 341-pound junior.
Yeah, it was just a quick rush. Watch, he gets beat off the snap. And isn't able to recover and instinctively just grabs. And that's, you know, you want him to keep his guy off the quarterback. But he just got beat off the first step on that rush.
And you saw Connor Shaw did hit the deck and he got up limping, but that was not Weatherly's fault because he was pushed in and kind of leg whipped underneath the legs of Connor Shaw. So it backs it up to second down at 21. Wants to throw a middle screen, does. Wilds on the run. Wilds in the open, Wilds is gone. Touchdown, South Carolina. Nobody touched him. Brennan Wilds, 33-yard touchdown reception.
Well, that's sloppy defense because you run the screen on second and long to get part of that yardage back and set up a manageable third down. And they just got an easy touchdown out of it. Good blocking downfield by the center, Stadnick, and the right guard, Ronald Patrick. But I think that was poor defense by Vanderbilt as much as anything.
Elliott Fry with a point after. Been a busy kicker tonight. It's good. 10:22 remaining in the third quarter. As if to say by South Carolina, Vandy, you might have gotten 10 quick points at the end of the half, but we're going to pick up where we left off to start the quarter. Capping a 75-yard drive on the 10th play, it's Brandon Wilds. Touchdown, Gamecocks. Celebrating its ninth year, sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets. Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. To date, Allstate's contributed more than $3 million in scholarship monies. South Carolina's had touchdown drives tonight of 42, 75, 76, 92, and 93 yards. And thus, 466 yards of offense. Brandon Wilds had the last touchdown, a 33-yard screen pass, and nobody touched him.
It's really a nice combination between Wilds and Mike Davis. They're both powerful guys, and they keep the legs fresh in that backfield.
Kickoff to Sims, about a yard deep. Turns on some extra burners and gets out near the 30-yard line. So that's where the offense comes back out, now trailing again by 25. James Franklin in his third year has done a nice job with Vandy. They've had some off-the-field issues for sure in the past 2.5-3 months, which he has tried to keep his team focused from those problems and tried to shoulder all of what's gone on in Nashville over the course of the last 3 months. We'll talk more about that in a second. Austin Carter Samuels in the shotgun on their first possession of the third quarter. He's going to go deep down the middle and got it to Jordan Matthews. And Matthews takes two or three Gamecocks to bring him down. But he got it across midfield down to the 49-yard line.
Well, they moved him to a different position. He's been out wide most of the game. This time he was in the tight slot. It's a lot harder to double him when he's in tight. He does a nice job getting behind the linebackers. He beats his man right off the play. That's Bryson Williams, the safety, who was covering him in the slot. And to get him the football early to start the third quarter.
At the 48-yard line. And out. Carter Samuels calls the play and then trots out as a wide receiver as they go the Wildcat. And this time, nice blocking. Seymour. All the way down inside the 30 to the 28-yard line. That's the best that's worked tonight, a pickup of 20.
Well, see, the difference is they didn't substitute. They didn't put the extra lineman in. Carter Samuels called the signals, then he went out wide. So South Carolina wasn't necessarily anticipating the run, and they caught him a little off balance with that adjustment at halftime. They didn't put the extra lineman in. They just shifted the quarterback out, direct snapped it to the running back. He got a nice game.
Fitz Lassing, the fullback, got the big block at the end to give him some extra yardage. So they got it first and 10 at the 28-yard line of South Carolina. Here comes a blitz on Carter Samuels. And he fires long, and it's incomplete. Closest man out there was Jonathan Krause. Krause, they expect some things from him this year in his senior season.
trying to take advantage of his opportunities here because it's his last year, and they think that the lights sort of come on for him. He's a really good punt returner, but they want him to be a bigger part of the passing game. They don't have Chris Boyd, who was a 50 reception guy a year ago because of what I was talking about with the issues that Vanderbilt's had. So Jordan Matthews is their big play receiver, but they don't really have a second guy. This time they flip it out to Matthews, and he's going to lose a couple of yards.
Second time they've run that play in the ball game. The first time it caught South Carolina off guard a little bit, and they were able to get a positive gain. This time South Carolina ready for it, got the loss of yardage play,
and it brings up third down and 11. And now Jadeveon Clowney coming from the other side, got some pressure. They get the pass away, and it's complete to Seymour, and he picked up about five, but that's it. Couldn't get to the first down marker. Now do you go on fourth down here halfway through the third quarter?
I think you might have to, because you realize defensively you don't have much chance stopping South Carolina. So I think you realize you're in the red zone or close to the red zone. You got to try to keep some offense going here.
Well, the faithful here at Williams-Brice knows what this one means, and they're going to try to make it rough on the Commodores and their quarterback.
Clowney is up on the left side this time, not on the right.
Second play in a row he's been up there. Carter Samuels throws over the top of him, and it's complete, and it's a first down to Chris Quintero. And that quiets the crowd as they've got it at the 17-yard line.
I don't quite understand why they had Clowney dropping in coverage, and maybe that's what Steve Spurrier's asking. Why take one of the premier pass rushers in the country and have him drop into coverage on Jordan Matthews?
And Steve said to Holly at halftime he doesn't throw the visor anymore, but it's on the ground right now. Wasn't crazy about his defense against Georgia, and wasn't crazy about it on that play. Look out. Here comes Clowney. Ball is out. South Carolina's got it.
Yeah.
That's a sack and a forced fumble.
That's a little better design than having him drop in coverage like they did on fourth down. Steve got his point across, and Jadeveon Clowney made a play.
And Kelsey Quarles is the guy that covered it. You could see that one coming from a mile away. Making his point, throwing the visor. Clowney responded. The All-American comes flying in, hits the quarterback. Ball is out. Carolina's got it.
ESPN College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Taco Bell's new fiery Doritos Locos Taco, Live Mas, and the all-new Kia Soul. Sleeker and more sophisticated than ever.
State Capitol here in Columbia, 35-10. Number 13, South Carolina leading Vanderbilt, and Jadeveon Clowney just gave it back to his offense.
Well, and Holly reported at the very beginning of the game that Jadeveon Clowney was given permission by Lorenzo Ward, the defensive coordinator. Whenever he wanted to switch sides, he could do that. And he was not having a lot of success against Wesley Johnson on the right side. He moved over against Andrew Bridges and beat him and got the sack and the turnover the last play.
They fake it to Wilds and come up throwing to Ellington. And Ellington, with blockers in front, ran out of real estate. He might have had a big, big gainer. Javon Marshall ran him out of bounds, but he did get 12. There's a flag down.
Holding on the offense, number 82. That's a 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay, first down.
Yeah, that's why he had some room to run. Quentin Smith, redshirt freshman, with a holding call. So just past the midway point of the third quarter, a 25-point lead for South Carolina. They're backed up now to their 16-yard line. It's a spot foul, so that's going to make it first and 17. Carter Samuels just wants the ball back with a chance to do something with the offense. They have done very little tonight. South Carolina's played extremely well on both sides of the ball, and now flags down again. And Matt Leffler is going to say,
before the snap,
false start.
False start on the offense. Number 50, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Check in with Holly.
Head linesman Gus Morris was injured just before the half. I do have an update. I am told that he suffered a concussion and a sprained ankle, but he did tell somebody he is feeling okay. Gus, we're thinking of you. Hope you feel better. His alternate official will stay out and finish the game.
Okay, great, Holly. We're waiting on that. Gus, you're probably watching the rest of the game. And we wish you the best on getting better soon and hopefully be back out officiating in the weeks to come. Mike Davis, and this time wrapped up by Kyle Westman, big junior out of Marietta, Georgia. Setting the edge over there and making the tackle with those penalties. This has kind of ruined the turnover forced by Clowney.
Yeah, that's right. Any momentum that they got from it is quickly gone away with the backwards movement here.
So they backed up to the 12 with a second and 21.
Second and long has been screened down for South Carolina in the ball game.
You don't have to get it all at once. Three wide receivers to Connor Shaw's right, and he's going to be running a quarterback draw. And he didn't get it all at once, but he did bring it up to third down and about 11. Third down, they were nearly perfect in the first half. Only missed one. And now third down and 11. Both the fullback and Brandon Wilds back there with Connor Shaw. Anytime you are 80% on your third down conversions, you've had a good night. Vandy was thinking about a blitz. They back out of it. Here's the swing pass to Wilds. And Wilds cuts up to the 30, but he didn't get to the first down marker. They got nine, but they needed a couple more.
Yeah, they didn't get it, but this play has been effective for them all night. And it's very simple. I mean, they're reading down the field, and then they got the back coming out. And if they cover down here, you dump it off to the back. It's just a simple read. Look downfield. If they cover that, dump it to the back, see if he can make somebody miss in space and turn a short catch into a long game. And they've had a lot of success.
Tell you what, these wide receivers for South Carolina, pretty good blockers, too.
Yeah.
Got a good one at the end of that play, but just a little bit shy for Wilds. And so Tyler Hall's got to kick it away. And fair catch. Look out, everybody. Stay away from the football. And it's going to bounce back to South Carolina territory.
Yeah, it was high and short to begin with. And then it worked its way backwards.
Finally, the Commodores have a short field to work with. They'll be in South Carolina territory when we come back. Well, the chase to the Sprint Cup officially starts tomorrow at Chicagoland Speedway. NASCAR's best drivers, including Jeff Gordon, start a 10-week battle for the championship. The Geico 400 at Chicago tomorrow, 1 o'clock on ESPN and live on the Watch ESPN app. There's your guys involved for the next 10 races. South Carolina raced out to an early lead in this one. Vanderbilt got 10 points in the final 3.5 minutes of the first half. Carter Samuels, the quarterback, split out to the right side again, and they go with Wesley Tate this time in the Wildcat. He's the bigger back in the group. And Tate, this is his first carry. And maybe should have put him in there earlier, all the way to the 31-yard line.
Well, that's the second time in the third quarter now that they didn't substitute the extra lineman. This time they called it in the huddle and then went with the shift. And they get equal numbers at the line of scrimmage and good upfield running by Wesley Tate.
First down at the 31. Chaz Sutton was a little bit slow getting up, but he's still sort of looking at the sideline. Like he might want to come out of there.
They actually ran the ball at Clowney that time and got a good game.
See if they can do it two times in a row. Waiting for his blockers, busting through. They do it two times in a row. And this is an 8-yard pickup. Kadetrix Marcus, who's been battling an injury and a shoulder injury, missed most of the game last week, and he was in on the tackle, and he's down again.
Fitz Lassing, the fullback, is doing a nice job blocking. I mean, it's just power running. A little counter, you got a guard pulling, you got the fullback leading. The guard gets Sutton, the fullback gets the linebacker, and back-to-back plays, Wesley Tate, positive game.
Tate, the senior, picks up positive yardage and has a short yardage situation for the Vanderbilt offense. Be second down with 3:28 to go when we come back. Well, the Wildcat has been working, Todd, the whole drive here for the Commodores.
Well, I think, again, the big reason that it's worked and it didn't work in the first half is they have not used the additional offensive linemen. Here they are again. Now, this time, they get a little heavier package in with the extra tackle playing the tight end.
Again, the hesitation. And another first down run and extra effort. Wesley Tate playing like he wants more snaps right now.
Well, Tate's running hard, and I think the offensive line got the message from their head coach, James Franklin, in the locker room at halftime, because they're coming out with a little bit more aggressiveness. That time, Clowney was lined up in the middle of the formation. They're trying to move him around. He's trying to get a little bit more active, and there's just a little feistiness, a new feistiness, I think, to this Vanderbilt offensive line here in the second half.
Now they've got quarterback under center in the red zone, and the pitch is to Tate, and Tate got a nice block, tripped up, or he might have had a big gainer, and he lost his shoe in the process.
Fitz Lassing again leading the play. Gerald Dixon with the shoestring tackle. Watch number 38 leading on the sweep. Nice block also by the right tackle, Andrew Bridges.
And now Carter Samuels in trouble. Clowney giving chase. He got a good block from him, and he'll tuck it and get out of bounds at the line of scrimmage. Got to give Wesley Johnson, we talked about the big left tackle, one of the captains, senior out of Nashville. Looked like Clowney maybe had Carter Samuels in his sights, but Carter Samuels, nice move, and then got the block from Johnson to keep number 7 off him. The Dietrichs, Marcus is back in after being shaken up a little bit earlier. Number 25 you see on the left-hand side of your screen.
Well, if you're going to throw on this third down play, I would make sure you have a back or a tight end over there to help on Clowney. I wouldn't let him rush one-on-one with your right tackle.
Got to think this is two down territory. 3 points doesn't do him much good at this stage of the ball game, and it's quarterback draw. Carter Samuels puts his head down, gets hit hard at the 10-yard line. And now we'll see if I'm right or wrong. It's fourth down and one.
Yep. Well, that's a play designed to take advantage of Jadeveon Clowney rushing upfield. They didn't even block him. They let him come upfield, and they ran the quarterback draw inside of him, and they got very close. Now it's fourth and short. I'd say they almost have to go to the direct snap here again. That's been their bread and butter so far in the third quarter.
Now this is to keep Vanderbilt in the ballgame right here.
Yep, see, there goes the quarterback out wide. They'll direct snap it, and Tate's the back.
Wesley Tate has done most of the damage on this drive. Can he get another yard? South Carolina knows he's going to run it, but can they stop him? No, they can't. First down.
He's a physical guy, 6'1", 224, a fifth-year senior out of Madison, Tennessee, and he's running with some aggressiveness right now. They have the extra lineman in. Andrew Jelks playing the tight end position. And they're getting good push.
He spent most of a couple years ago as a wide receiver and kind of wishes he would have been able to stay at tailback. They just had a need at wide receiver. But I can see that it's nice to have hands coming out of the backfield or have that experience. But he's a good-looking runner right here when he's just getting the snap and going for it. Let's see if he'll go for it again. First and goal at the 6. And this time, only a yard gain. Kawan Lewis, one of the linebackers, made the first hit. Tate's got 38 yards on the ground on this drive alone, Ledge.
Yep. Well, they found something that's working. Now, the only problem is, as they get closer to the goal line, you know, the field gets shorter, and South Carolina's going to stack that line of scrimmage a little bit more, so they'll be unblocked guys that Tate's going to have to take on in these runs.
Well, they're going to have to wait and run it on the other end. We'll switch ends about 95 yards. The SEC on ESPN as we played three quarters. Vanderbilt threatening to start the fourth quarter, but they're going to need all they can do in the fourth. They're down by 25. The SEC on ESPN from Columbia, South Carolina, as we start the fourth quarter. The Gamecocks in command, but Vanderbilt's Commodores to start the fourth have it first and goal at the South Carolina 5.
I don't know if Vanderbilt has anything like this in their offensive repertoire, but if they had some kind of a pop pass, a Tebow-esque kind of play out of this direct snap, I think it'd be wide open here on second down.
They've had 8 plays, all rushes on this drive. Tate again. He thought about it at that time, and now he's going to run to the corner and get to the one.
That's what they were looking to do, and it was covered. South Carolina had good defensive discipline, but they tried to release the tight end, and South Carolina had it covered.
Now they're inside the 1 yard line with a third and goal.
Well, now again, you go to that same issue. If you go shotgun, you take the ball from the 1 yard line and automatically put it on the 6 with the snap. Do you go under center with your quarterback? And that's what Vanderbilt is electing to do. Nope, they're gonna go shotgun.
Curtis Samuel. Pump fakes and he'll run it himself for the touchdown. So both quarterbacks, all 3 quarterbacks tonight, showing that they can score on the ground. And Curtis Samuel's a senior.
Offside on the defense, number 15. That penalty is declined. The touchdown is good.
With a 1 yard touchdown run.
And that little pump fake, it didn't do much, but it did enough. It moved the linebackers just enough outside to set up a block and get the ball in the end zone on the quarterback run.
Carey Spear in for the point after. There's still a lot of time left in this football game. It's about to be an 18-point difference. Up and good. 35-17. The Vanderbilt has made it a ball game, and we still have the entire fourth quarter to go. Curtis Samuel, there's that fake, and there's the 1 yard play. +35-17 now in our college football primetime presented by Hampton Hotels. Todd shows the touchdown again.
Well, these 3 guys are affected by the pump fake. Clowney's going to come up field, and these 2 guys are going to move just enough that way to allow blocks to be fitted and Curtis Samuel to get the ball in the end zone. It caused just enough movement to allow blockers to get in position and Curtis Samuel to get the ball into the end zone. Pretty well executed play right there on the goal line.
Sure was. Capped off a 49-yard drive, 10 plays, a little over 5 minutes. And it's made it 35-17. Remember, at one point, this game was very lopsided before 10 points in the final 3.5 minutes of the second quarter to at least give Vanderbilt some hope. Now they've got more hope with another touchdown. Sean Carson from a yard deep. And he took a big hit.
Ball's out.
And the ball's out, I think.
And that's exactly, if it is, what Vanderbilt needed.
Vandy's got it. They do. Wow, what a play. Williamson comes up with a ball on the special teams. There's the collision. Ball is out.
Number 30 got his head right on the football.
Larry Franklin.
Yep. I mean, he's got it protected. It's in there. But a big shot by Larry Franklin. The ball came out. And Vanderbilt right back in business.
In the red zone. At the 19 of South Carolina.
Well, they're going to check and see if his knee was down before the ball came out.
So again, they'll go to replay.
Ruling was a fumble.
Sean Carson suffered through a couple of seasons of having injuries, had an ACL when he was a freshman and missed all but the bowl game last year with a wrist injury. And now it's his feelings that are hurt, if indeed that's a fumble. Meanwhile, Vanderbilt's offense is over there thinking up strategy to try to make this a very close game. Here's another look. Balls. His knee's not down yet. And the ball is out before it touches, in my opinion.
And again, the ruling on the field was a fumble recovered by Vanderbilt. It has to be undisputable evidence to overturn that call.
This one's quick.
Yeah.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. It was a fumble recovered by Vanderbilt.
Yep.
First down, Vanderbilt.
So let's see what the Doors offense can do.
In the last possession, it was a lot of direct snap to Wesley Tate. Let's see if they start this possession the same way. Tate is the back in the game for Vanderbilt.
He's been the hot hand or the hot legs. And now it's Carter Samuels.
Now this is an off-balance line. The tight end is to the left. They're looking for a trick play to the tight end.
Middle screen to Tate. Tate straight up the gut. Tate, touchdown.
Great play.
19 yards right after the fumble kick.
Great, great play because South Carolina was anticipating the trick play. This is a tight end, and they're expecting the throw there. All their checks are to cover the tight end, and nobody took Tate coming out of the backfield. They fooled the South Carolina defense with their alignment, and they got the touchdown in one play.
And they're going to go for two. Carter Samuels in the backfield with Tate again. Two-point conversion attempt. Matthews is in tight on the left. Gonna throw that way to the tight end, and they got the two-point conversion to Stephen Choi. Wow, all of a sudden, football game in Columbia.
Yep.
One play after the recovery of the fumble kick. Carter Samuel throws to the middle to Tate. He goes 19 yards. They're going for two to try to make it a 10-point game, and he finds Choi is tight end in the corner. Ball game right now, 35-25.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by Hampton Hotels. Feel the Hamptonality. And in part by America's Navy, a global force for good.
There were a few people that left Williams-Brice Stadium. They maybe shouldn't have. 35-25. As Vandy, after the fumble recovery on the kickoff,
yeah,
takes it one play and then a two-point conversion.
Two turnovers, and they capitalized on both of them with touchdowns and right back in the football game.
Vanderbilt scored 15 points in the last 13 seconds. Got Bruce Ellington back now as the kick return man, not Sean Carson. He's the guy that dropped the last one. And Ellington says, I don't want to touch it either. We'll bring it out to the 25. We'll take a look at our good hands play brought to you by Allstate. Could be a good call play by Allstate too, Todd.
Well, this is a one-time shot. It's a tackle over. This is an offensive lineman. He's not an eligible receiver. This is. South Carolina is ready for the tight end, but they're not ready for Wesley Tate. They don't have enough guys over here to defend the screen to Tate. He has to catch it behind the line of scrimmage, what he does, and then he has a clear path to the end zone. It was a beautifully timed call by offensive coordinator John Donovan, and that's one of those plays. You get it one time a game. They got the look they wanted, and they paid it off with a touchdown.
And we told you Wesley Tate's a former receiver, so he's got good hands, obviously, and knew what to do with it as a running back once he touched it. And now Vandy's going to blitz on first down. Connor Shaw keeps it, runs up the middle. Connor Shaw, 15 yards, 20 yards, big gainer for the quarterback.
Yep. That was just good patience by Connor Shaw, because you called it. There was an inside blitz. Vanderbilt brought two guys up into the A gap, and that means there's nobody in the second level of the defense. So as soon as Shaw was able to get to that part of the defense, he had some open field to run. He was patient to allow the traffic to clear and then got a nice run out of it.
He got across the 45 for a first down. 13 and a half minutes to go. Shaw in the gun. Play fake. Keeps it again and only got about a yard. As did the ball come out at the end? Let's go to second. Nope. They're going to say he was down. Let's check in with Reese Davis. Reese.
All right, Brad, Ole Miss playing Texas. That game's on the Longhorn Network. Rebels jumped out 14-0. Texas scored 23 in a row. Jonathan Gray going in here. Rebs kicked a 52-yard field goal on the final play of the half, so 23-17 at the break. It's on the Longhorn Network. On ESPN2, Mississippi State and Auburn playing a good one. 5.5 to play, dogs up 3.
All right, here in the SEC, a second down and 9 for South Carolina. Blitz coming on Shaw. Flares it out, complete to the tight end, gets what he can, puts his hand down and dives in the Vanderbilt territory. Jarrell Adams. Connor Shaw's hit his last 7 passes, and he's 21 out of 27.
I think you got to go after him on this third down play. They were perfect on third down the first half. You got to pressure him and see if you can force him into a mistake.
Got the tight end, Rory Anderson, in the slot. Now he's going to come in to help give Connor Shaw some time. But still, 3 wide receivers for Shaw. Slant is too far in front of Bruce Ellington.
I like the decision by Vanderbilt. They did bring pressure. They brought extra guys. They left themselves with man-to-man coverage. And Connor Shaw, one of his few inaccurate throws of the night.
And how about Connor Shaw? He pointed as if to say, let's go for it on fourth. And Steve Spurrier said, I don't think so.
No.
Got to punt it here.
Yeah, you don't want to give Vanderbilt any more reason to get excited. And a short field on a missed fourth down makes no sense.
Again, the kick to the far side. And a diving catch, good catch, by Jonathan Krause around the 21. So with 11:59 remaining in the ball game, guess who's got the ball back, only trailing by 10. Commodores of Vanderbilt trying to pull a shocker and trying to have a miracle comeback. Still a long way to go. Take a look at our Discover game changer. This game has definitely changed. Carter Samuels with that pump fake and goes in from a yard out with a touchdown that started the comeback. And this is just huge right here, Todd.
Yeah, they've had 2 turnovers they forced, and both of them have led directly to scores. The very next play, the trick play, the throw to Tate, and they're right back in the football game. And in the second half particularly, they've had a short field to work with. And that is that's helped them, because they were struggling against this Carolina defense in the first half with the long field.
Remember, they scored 15 points in 13 seconds over that stretch we just showed you. And now trying to throw a slip screen out to Jordan Matthews, and the ball was thrown well behind him and too low. Kelsey Quarles kind of messed that one up, getting his big body in the way.
Probably better that it was dropped,
yeah,
because it was going to be a loss of yardage play. That screen worked well the first time they ran it, and the last couple times South Carolina has been right on it. Which means what's set up is to fake that screen and look to throw it down the field. If they're overplaying that screen, you got to do something off of that action.
Second down and 10. Pump fake, and now a run all the way by the quarterback. Carter Samuels got 2, but it's going to be 3rd down and 8. Marquise Roberts in on the stop. Clock winding its way around the 11-minute mark. They're going to come up and hurry up here, so it'll be around 11 and a half when they snap it. Big 3rd down.
Clowney is lined up on the right end, and Chaz Sutton is on the same side as him, so they're 2 best pass rushers on the same side.
Down the middle, tips, incomplete, almost intercepted. T.J. Holloman got a hand on that one en route, number 11.
Holloman playing linebacker. He's running underneath this route, and he gets his hands on it, and that's why they were able to make contact with the receiver. Because there was a tipped ball, that's not pass interference. You're allowed to hit the receiver after the ball's tipped.
So the punting unit comes out. Last time Taylor Hudson kicked it, he kicked it 75 yards. They'd like another one of those right here. And it's Victor Hampton. Came in averaging a little over 7 per return. Low snap. He gets it out of there. This one's not going to go 75 yards unless it bounces for about 40.
Hit it.
South Carolina player.
I think they got it again.
Battle underneath.
It was a low rugby type kick. And T.J. Gurley, I think, didn't know where the football was, and it hit his leg.
Don't have a signal from the referee yet. The officials having a committee meeting. Steve Spurrier's in the middle of it.
And they need to get away from the players and the coaches and make a decision.
The ruling on the field, it was touched by the receiving team, recovered by the kicking team. First down for Vanderbilt.
Holy smokes. Vandy's got it back again.
The problem is that not the return man, but one of the blockers, Gurley, doesn't know where the ball is. And it hit his foot clearly.
It did, hit his left foot.
It changed the course of the football. And it looks like Vanderbilt got the ball.
Could be Darius Sims on the bottom, number six. Hard to tell.
Now, part of that is Hampton, the return man. He's got to be yelling to his blockers to get away from the ball, to let them know where it is.
First down, at any rate. South Carolina trying to not implode right here. Carter Samuels comes out as a wide receiver. Here comes a blitz. Tate's going to take it up the middle. He's got a first down and more.
Boy, they just have the right answers now. Little fakes. They fake the counter to the left and design the run back. Watch the movement to the left by Tate. That sends the linebackers that way, and then he follows the tight end, Choi, right up through the middle. Well-designed play. Right now, John Donovan is dialing up some excellent calls against this South Carolina defense.
First down. Inside the Carolina 25. Toss sweep. Tate trying to follow his blockers. Will get back to the line of scrimmage. Actually, he's going to lose a yard. Jadeveon Clowney helped to blow that one up on that side.
You still have your most dynamic player as Jordan Matthews.
Tate again cuts back to the middle. He's got a first down and more. And Clowney trying to rip it out of his hands. Did make the tackle, but it's first and goal.
This South Carolina defense had their way in the first half. Didn't have to run a whole lot of plays. Second half, a different story. They're playing in their own end of the field, and they look a little bit out of sync right now. We saw that last week against Georgia, when Georgia gashed them pretty good. And right now, Vanderbilt has the upper hand.
First and goal at the nine. Jerron Seymour this time in the Wildcat. He's bumped down after a pickup of a couple. With 10 minutes to go in the first half, Todd, it was 28-0.
Yeah.
35-25. And Vandy, barring some kind of major catastrophe, is going to at least get three out of this, or a field goal attempt. But they're thinking touchdown, obviously. Second down and goal. At the 8-yard line of the Gamecocks. Seymour trying to follow his blockers, got to the 5. That brings up third down and goal.
Seymour looks a little more hesitant than Tate. Tate had to come out to get a break. Now it's third down, and it's probably a passing situation. But Tate has really given them a boost offensively.
Jadeveon Clowney is not in there right now either. Third goal at the 5.
Well, this has to be Jordan Matthews' time. I mean, he's definitely going to be the number one look on this play. And here he is right here in the slot.
Curtis Samuels in the shotgun. Watch the football. Comes the other way on the slant. It's intercepted in the end zone. Jimmy LeGree. Intended for Cunningham.
I don't get that. I don't get the read. You go to Cunningham, the true freshman. I can see it maybe if he gets wide open, but this is pretty good coverage by LeGree. He's not open.
And he would have been better off to take a knee right there. He fell out of the end zone at the 1-foot line. Might have been pushed or tackled by Cunningham out to the 1-foot line. Yeah, got to take a look at this one as well. Great play on the ball, yeah. Either way.
You know, that's a case of a defensive back just out-muscling the young wide receiver. I mean, he just fought harder for the ball. Cunningham did not help his quarterback very much. You know, when you run that slant route, he's got to stay between the defender and the football. And Legree just bullied him. He just pushed him out of the way.
You got to box out with your body a little bit somehow. Instead, Jimmy Legree hops in front.
I just think when you're in that situation on that kind of play, you got to go to your best player. I mean, Tate's on the bench because he's tired. The best player on the field for you right there is Jordan Matthews. You got to give him a chance to make a play for you in the end zone. Don't go away from him unless the coverage dictates you have to go away from him.
The review is not whether or not it was an interception. The review is going to be whether or not Legree was in the end zone or was at the 1 foot line. And there's a major difference.
Yep.
Touchback and breathing room or 1 foot line for your offense. And the ruling on the field is the 1 foot line.
Yeah. Well, again, all that came down to was Curtis Samuels thought he had a one-on-one matchup, and that was to his advantage, but it ended up not being it because Legree's a senior and Cunningham's a freshman, and the senior just out-muscled the young receiver and made a play on the football.
Well, again, we wait on the replay, and we're about ready to get word from our referee. Here's the call.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. It's an interception on the 1 yard line for South Carolina.
So that means that Connor Shaw, or at least his center, will be over the ball with his feet in the end zone as well. The last thing you want here is a safety and getting the ball back in 35-27. But it's that close. Length of the football.
I wouldn't be shocked if Steve Spurrier doesn't go play action here and trust his quarterback, Connor Shaw, to make a good decision. Vanderbilt expecting run. Your quarterback is a smart guy. Maybe take a shot for a play.
Well, he called it, partner. Here it comes. And almost intercepted by Andre Hall. Made a nice play on the ball on the far side.
Yeah, he was right on it. This is a long throw. It's all the way across the field, an out route, kind of a dangerous throw, and Hall was in perfect position. I mean, he was squatting on the route and made a beautiful play.
It's intended for Demir Byrd. Now you almost got to go back to Mike Davis to try to blast it out of there, don't you? The fullback, McLaurin's in there. And again, those guys are 4 yards or so deep in the end zone.
They've got a penalty. They had 12 guys on the field.
Illegal substitution on the offense. 12 men in the formation, half the distance to the goal, second down.
And that's going to be about the 8-inch line. You can't get any closer to the goal line going the wrong way than what South Carolina has right now.
Yeah. And now you may even have to go quarterback sneak, go under the center and go sneak to get a little breathing room.
And he's only got 4 guys on the defensive line. Shaw in the gun. He'll have to throw from here. Well, maybe not. There's Connor Shaw, what he does best. And he might have a first down. Boy, they let one get away there, the Commodores defense. The crowd reacting, they didn't like the spot. Well, it's 3rd down and 1. Now they do line up under center with an eye backfield. So it'll be a big first down, and Connor Shaw's got it.
Oh, what a good read by Connor Shaw. The defense of Vanderbilt bunched inside. They covered the guard. Look, they bunch inside, and Connor Shaw just going to take the sneak right there. He sees the inside move, and he just waits a half a step and goes outside for the easy conversion.
His fullback says, "I didn't know you were going to do that, dude, but it was a nice play."
Why go in there and get an unnecessary headache when you can just go a little bit outside and fall to the ground and get a first down?
Now, 7.5 minutes to go, and South Carolina with a first down, clinging to a 10-point lead, but in much better shape now. Davis Not a tough two or three.
One thing that Vanderbilt's defense has not been able to do tonight is they've had South Carolina pinned down deep a couple times, and they've not been able to keep them down there. They've gotten turnovers, but they've not been able to keep them down deep.
They started three drives inside the 10, including the 12-inch line, yeah. And they've worked their way out of every issue they've had down there on a long field. Two tight ends here on second down and 7. They can take their time now. South Carolina like to use as much game clock as they can. We're under 7 minutes. And it's Connor Shaw all the way. Tripped up short of the first down. He's within a yard or two of it.
See, this is the same situation we saw last week, just with the shoe on the other foot. Georgia had a 2-score lead and the ball, and they could take their time. They could extend the game because they knew that the opponent needed to score twice. And that's the situation Vanderbilt's in right now. They've got to score twice, and South Carolina can use as much clock as they can.
It's amazing. You said it's almost the same time in the fourth quarter last week, and yep. Georgia ran out the clock.
Yep.
So that's what South Carolina's going to try to do here 7 days later. High snap, 3rd and 2. Option. Davis has got the first down. He's got a bunch more. Mike Davis, another good run.
Kind of a creative pitch by Connor Shaw, too. It was almost like a little forward pass. It wasn't your normal pitch. Watch, it's kind of a throw pitch. Good balance by Mike Davis, and he stays in bounds. And again, that's what you tell your backs right now. Get what you can get and go down and stay in bounds and keep that clock running.
Another 80-yard night after back-to-back hundreds. He might have 100 before this one's over, too, if they keep feeding it to him. They've traveled 35 yards on this drive, and they've worked it under the 6-minute mark. Taken 3 minutes off the clock so far. This time Davis will lose yardage. And nice play by Harding Harper. Let's check in with Reese Davis. Reese.
Brad, SportsCenter right now brought to you by Ally Bank. Headline game of the day, Alabama and Texas A&M. Crimson Tide wins it 49-42. McCarron threw for 4 touchdowns. Johnny Manziel, 464 yards, 5 scores, but a couple of big interceptions. LSU and Kent State, LSU no trouble, 45-13. Mettenberger throwing for 3 more touchdowns. LSU and Auburn coming up next week.
All right, Reese, this was a laugher in the first half. It's not that funny anymore, but South Carolina at the 5-minute mark has a 10-point lead. Option coming the other way to Brandon Wilds, and Wilds, a big hole. Holding out of the football for dear life, and he's close to a first down. Mike Davis limped off after that last play where he lost a couple of yards.
You mentioned earlier these wide receivers for South Carolina blocking downfield. Bruce Ellington is one tough dude now. He gets another good block. Watch him leading the block right there on the safety. Stays right engaged with him, and Wilds runs right by him.
We got a Vandy player down. And I think it's Adam Butler, the redshirt freshman defensive tackle. South Carolina's run it 7 straight times, most of them by the quarterback and some by Mike Davis. The last one by Wilds has him 3rd down and 2, 3rd down and 1 when we come back. The SEC on ESPN, another good game tonight, another good network upcoming, SEC Network. Traditions found a new home. It launches August 2014. For more info, go to GetSECNetwork.com. Now, this one was all South Carolina at 28-0. Vanderbilt had an opportunity about 4 minutes ago to make it a field goal game, but an interception in the end zone by Jimmy LeGree. Or actually at the 1-yard line. And now 44 yards and 8 plays later, South Carolina's got some breathing room, but they still need this 3rd down and a yard. And this time it's really tough. I'm not going to call this one. I think he might be a little bit short. I guess I just did call it. Connor Shaw has had so many big chunks of yardage tonight. He needed a yard there, and he might not have gotten that much.
South Carolina took over the football on their own 1 with 8 minutes and 41 seconds left in the ball game. And they have moved it out and chewed up clock and kept the ball away from Vanderbilt.
They're going to bring the sticks out to look at this one. Let's check in with Holly.
Well, they measured this. Let me just update. Mike Davis of South Carolina, their good running back, has been taken to the sideline, sitting on the training table. They are examining his left ankle. He was complaining of some hydration issues and cramps earlier in the game. They've been hydrating him, but this time they've cut the tape off his ankle, and he does appear to be in some pain. I'll check on Adam Butler of Vanderbilt next, guys.
All right, Holly, thanks. Length of the football shy. What do you do here, partner? Fourth down and a foot.
Oh, boy.
Ooh. They're at the 46-yard line, their own.
I think part of it is you say, you know what, if we can't make fourth and a foot at home, we don't deserve to win this football game.
If they don't get this, it's a short field again for Randy.
It is. I think this is the right call. I think you go for it and you let your quarterback run the football.
He got a fourth and one earlier with that shifty little move to just bounce it outside and ignore the would-be block by his fullback. He's going to try it again, and he got it again. A little different play, but yeah, same result.
And the important thing is the clock continues to run.
Now Vandy will have to start thinking about using its timeouts. Boy, he paid the price for that one, almost lost his helmet. And the head ball coach says, there we go.
And again, now you go back to taking your time, working clock, and then still running positive plays. You know, you don't want to get complacent offensively, but you want to use as much of the play clock and the game clock as you can.
Ellington comes in, settles in on that wing to the right side. And up the middle goes Brandon Wilds to midfield. 10 straight runs for South Carolina from their probably 10-inch line to about 10 inches shy of the 50. It's nice to have a guy like Brandon Wilds.
Yep.
They rotate. He rotates with Mike Davis anyway, and he's the bigger of the two considerably, 6'2", 225 pounds. So he's about 5 inches taller and 10 pounds heavier than Mike. But he's really been needed tonight. First to spell Davis just to give him a breather, and now with Mike on the sideline, Brandon's getting most of the work when Connor Shaw's not running it. And here he comes again, and he blasts his way to the 45 of Vanderbilt.
We have another third and short. Looks like Vanderbilt might be taking a timeout.
And there's their first with 2:35 remaining. Another third down coming up, but getting Carolina off the field on third down has not been easy tonight. In fact, it's been almost impossible.
Well, part of that is you have a quarterback that you're facing that is a constant threat to run, whether by design or by scramble. If the play's not there, the pass play call. And he makes good decisions with the football in his hand.
Don't forget, get your NFL Sunday started on ESPN tomorrow at 10 o'clock. NFL Countdown, Chris Berman and the gang with all the latest news and updates from around the league right up until kickoff. And at 11 on ESPN2, flip over and catch Fantasy Football Now. The latest news, injury reports, and predictions for the top fantasy performers. I think if there was a fantasy performer tonight, it would have to be Connor Shaw. And then when Dylan Thompson came in, he did about as well.
Yeah.
We mentioned Connor Shaw. He's perfect when he plays here. If this holds up, he'll be 12-0 at home. Blitz coming from the Commodores. Wilds is going to try to run right by it. And he got three and a first down. And now James Franklin looks up there thinking about another timeout. But
it's kind of a helpless feeling.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, this thing started inside their 1 yard line. You can't get them off the field. You had a chance to score, to make it a one possession game. And you can look up at that clock and you say, we're running out of time. We got to score twice and we can't get them off the field. And it's a pretty helpless feeling for a coach.
It's going to be down right around 2 minutes remaining when Connor Shaw takes this next snap. On a first down at the Vanderbilt 42 yard line. Wilds got three. Jake Seelan made the stop. We talked about the game last week when that same helpless feeling was on the South Carolina side when Georgia ran off the last 8:28 off the clock. South Carolina trying to do the same. A timeout here. We've got time to check in with Reese.
All right, Brad, that's some tight games. Been a little bit of a surprising day for Purdue, which has not played well in his first couple of games. Rob Henry to B.J. Knopf, and they're trying to knock off the Fighting Irish at 17-10 on ABC, getting very late in the third. Joel Stavi and the Badgers at great ground. Game has been rolling, but it hasn't been tested. It will be in 5.5 minutes by Arizona State.
And we'll try to get you right to that game when we're done. This drive, 14 plays, 60 yards, 4 first downs. And we mentioned they've chewed up the majority of the clock, just like Georgia did to South Carolina last week. South Carolina's doing it to Vanderbilt tonight. And Vandy can only stop it one more time.
You have to be impressed with the resiliency of both teams. You know, Vanderbilt was out of this game early, 28-0. They got the turnover. They fought themselves back into the game. Then they had a burst there in the third quarter where they really looked like they were gaining momentum in the game. They closed the gap. South Carolina looked a little bit out of it, and then they have responded with an incredible drive here.
And with 2 seconds on the play clock, they give it off to Brandon Wilds for a yard. Adam Butler in on the stop, but the clock is Vandy's enemy, so they have to stop it the final time right here. With a minute 48 remaining and a third down coming up, but South Carolina have 2 plays to try to pick up that first down, and if they do it in 2 plays, the lights are out at Williams-Brice until we leave. Connor Shaw had a couple of drop passes, but pinpoint threading the needle passes, part of the touchdowns tonight. Mike Davis, another tough ground game. Shaw again, this time on a perfect throw to Bruce Ellington. 111 yards, career high for Ellington, who had not been a big part of the offense the first 2 weeks, but certainly tonight he was huge. Not only as a receiver, but as a blocker.
And just been so well documented. Also a starter on the basketball team. Such a hard double duty thing in today's world of college athletics. To be as good as he is in both sports is pretty commendable.
Nothing like a 16 play drive so far to try to ice the game. And South Carolina takes a timeout. Something Steve Spurrier didn't like, and Steve walked out on the field and took it himself. So some of the things they were worried about coming off the loss to Georgia last week, for the most part, they've alleviated that. Now, you're going to say, well, the defense has given up all these points. But remember, 10 points were scored,
right,
one on a turnover that went down to the 1-yard line, and then they got a 54-yard field goal. So I know coordinators always say, well, if you take those 2 plays away,
that's right.
We love that, don't we?
I do think they played better, though. They got lined up. They were a little bit more active. They were a little bit more in sync. You know, the turnovers really kept Vanderbilt in the game. They capitalized on those turnovers. But the resiliency here, taking the ball over, they get the turnover, first of all, take over on the one, then their offensive line just really asserts itself. And it's been a good football game. Both teams have fought, but South Carolina looks like they're going to come away with a much-needed win.
Wilds now trying to take it wide. He doesn't want to go out of bounds, and he just backpedals his way close to a first down. It is going to be fourth down at about a yard, yard and a half. But again, the clock's just going to work its way down here. And even if Vanderbilt was to get a stop, they would have about a minute to try to get 10 points. Of course, they got 15 in 13 seconds, but that was a little different scenario. 15 straight running plays by South Carolina. If you would have told Steve Spurrier that when he was at Florida, he would look at you and call you crazy, completely crazy.
I wonder if he appreciates the irony and recognizes it the same way we do, of that he was in this exact same situation, only on the helpless side, a week ago.
So timeout on a 4th and 2 upcoming. And South Carolina only 1 timeout remaining. South Carolina, their schedule upcoming looks like this. At UCF, and did they win tonight?
Yeah, they beat Penn State tonight.
I didn't mean to bring that up, partner. I'm sorry. And then Kentucky at home, and then three road games in the SEC, Arkansas, Tennessee, Missouri.
Right, and as we talked about last week, you know, the Georgia schedule, on paper anyway, a little bit more challenging, it looks like, than South Carolina's, particularly as you look who they play in the West. Georgia, on the 28th, has LSU coming into Athens, and that's a much more formidable task than as you look at South Carolina's schedule right now.
Sort of a weird twist, of course, South Carolina beating Georgia the last 2 years, but Georgia making it to the Dome in Atlanta as the SEC East champion. So this will at least help the Gamecocks keep pace, that is, with the idle Georgia Bulldogs. Georgia's off today. Fourth down and two with a minute to go. And slipping and going down is Wilds, and he got drilled by Kenny Ladler, who's the leading tackler for Vanderbilt tonight. As we check in with Reese Davis, Vandy's going to get the ball back.
All right, guys, you see Dave Pass, Brian Greasy there on ESPN2. We're going to go ahead and kick off Wisconsin and Arizona State just as soon as we're finished in Columbia. We'll move that game back over to ESPN. Look at the temperature there in Tempe, 97 degrees, no humidity nor chance of rain, and the Badgers are about to kick it away.
Dave and Greece and Tom are sweating. We're not. It's beautiful tonight, but we've still got 55 seconds to play. Carter Samuels has got to come up slinging it now, but he's not going to get a chance. Buried by Harris and Sutton.
Mason Harris, you talk about fresh legs. He came off the edge with a burst.
No way to stop it. Timeout-wise for Vanderbilt. Slant. Jordan Matthews trying to make something happen. He'll be short of the first down, and they're going to have to hustle.
Yep, got to go. Got to get the first down. You know, right here on third down, the clock will stop a little bit if you can convert the first down.
Got to hurry. Under 20 seconds. Carter Samuels in the backfield, running for his life and throwing on the run. Incomplete. It's fourth down, and there's 11 seconds left. Well, it turned into a good football game, but the Commodores are going to go home 1-2. And South Carolina, with Georgia being idle, will have a tie for the second longest home winning streak right now. It'll be 13 straight here at Williams-Brice Stadium for the Gamecocks.
There's that other team in the East that hasn't even played a conference game yet, the Florida Gators. Outstanding defensive football team. Offense had a few problems in their loss to Miami a week ago.
Carter Samuels, time might run out by the time he completes this play and ball to Matthews. It'll add to his stats, but it's not going to add to the scoreboard. 1 second remaining. Still coaching.
I don't know if they can get the ball snapped.
No, they can't. No.
1 second, you can't get lined up and get it snapped.
A good ball game. The head ball coach wins his 68th game here, 210th of his career. Got to be a struggle after a while, though, didn't it? That's gonna